All righty, well, good afternoon, everybody. This is the Brain Trust. So thank you for coming out this evening, spending the evening with us as we embark on our strategic planning team processes. This is a phase that's now moving into the planning of goals, strategies, action plans, timelines, all of those things, as we gear up toward really this second phase of strategic planning. The first phase was really developing understanding of emerging industries, 21st century skills, how millennials are wired, and we're going to kind of debrief on all of those sessions we had back in the fall and into January. So this really kicks off from today forward, really that whole building of goals and kind of where we're going from here in terms of the directionality of the district. So we're so pleased to have you all this evening to be involved with that process. I'm Jim Schwartz, the superintendent of Avondale Schools. This is Suzanne Klein, Dr. Suzanne Klein from Holcomb University. Together we're going to facilitate these meetings to guide us through this journey of essentially developing the future roadmap for Avondale Schools. You know, interestingly, the roadmap actually began, or had its beginnings last year when we started with the restructuring of central office. When I came into the district, the current structure that was here was really not conducive to having a really, or delivering on a really robust strategic plan. There were some critical positions that needed to be brought in for that to happen. We had a couple of retirements at central office last year, which allowed us the financial capability to invest that into positions that would assist us in that regard. One being a curriculum of instruction, curriculum and instruction position. So we created that assistant superintendent position. It had been over almost a decade since that position was in the district previously. So there's a lot of work that's needed there in terms of revisions of curriculum, current curriculums, and then looking at new program growth and directionality moving forward. So we brought in Carmen Kennedy, who is critical in that capacity. Secondly is marketing. Marketing, PR, branding, communications, and Annette McAvoy has filled that void as we move to get the word out, the positive messages about Avondale within the community and outside the community, because that's very critical for our growth as a school district. So two critical positions really that started to cement the foundation of the strategic planning. And then as we moved into the fall, we had those sessions at each of the buildings, which we'll come back to and talk about in a little bit. And then our January session, where we visited some of the mission, vision, belief statements, kind of where we look to go as a school district statement-wise. And we're going to be referring to those coming up in day three of our sessions. And then now into the planning stages. So these planning stages are planning to be about 5 to 6 meetings. This is day one. We'll be looking between now and really the middle of May, really shoring up on the plans. Day one and day two, which is today and next Thursday, and we'll get you these agendas in your binders shortly. For you to get information about the school district. It is really a state of the union, state of the district, where by department, by level of school, you'll be getting information about everything there is current about the school district. You're going to be on data overload after these 2 days. And all the reference materials will be in your binders that you can refer to as we go to looking at goal setting. Because that'll provide the springboard for where do we go. All the feedback from the community surveys, all the feedback from the forums, plus all of the data supporting test scores and finances and you name it, you're going to have it all at your fingertips. Because that information is critical for us to say, okay, where do we go next? Where does the community say we should go next? So all of that we're going to be reviewing with you along the way over these first 2 days. So a lot of information that's going to be coming your way. to start the afternoon, I thought maybe we'd just go around. We had 55 respondents that were going to attend, so we don't have 55 here, but maybe, you know, folks will be trickling in as the evening goes. You know, unfortunately, it's, you know, the weather is not always cooperating, and this is rescheduled from the prior snow days, so I'm sure there's numerous variables as to why the 55 who said they're coming aren't necessarily here right now. But nonetheless, hopefully we'll get some more folks that will trickle in, and same thing with day two and so on. So folks may pop in, pop out, and add where they can. And that's my invitation to you as well. If you can't make all the meetings, that's fine. Please join us and give us your input and be involved where you can. We'll take anything you got. So we appreciate that. Okay, so with that, we're going to, I'm gonna turn the microphone over to Suzanne to kind of get us going with some icebreaker activities. We do have some dinner, which I know folks are hungry. We wanna get going with that shortly. And then we'll kind of roll out from there in terms of some of the specific data points.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to finally get this process started, because you've had a wonderful conversation across your community as school opened. As Dr. Schwarz and others visited around your schools, you've had a chance to watch the school year unfold. And now, as he said a moment ago, it's time to bring the think tank together to say, what do we know about this school district? Where are its strengths? Where is it? And have some wonderful opportunities that we want to explore. What kinds of things do we see in its future that we aspire to be? And then how might we really make those things happen? So you are here with that opportunity to really help create the future for the school district, because there is a blank sheet of paper. There is not a plan that's been written on a napkin. There's not a plan in a notebook. The plan is going to come out of your collective heads. We'll talk in a minute about what that process is going to look like. But right now, you are the coalition of the willing who said, yes, I am glad to come and think. I am glad to come and plan. How many of you came to the community conversation in January that was over at the middle school? Wonderful. You had a chance that day to hear a bit about workforce development and getting ready for college, and the kinds of things that we want all learners to know and be able to do. You also heard the perspective of three very articulate young men and women who had come through Avondale schools, and what they found as they went out in the world after their K-12 experience. So with that in mind, and some other things we're going to have available to you for information, we hope you're going to be extremely well prepared to make some very important decisions and recommendations. So with that, what we'd like to do, again, as Dr. Schwarz said, there were 50-some people who said yes, they could come, to give people just a quick idea about who is in the room tonight. So if you could stand up and turn around and face the group and just tell them your name and say, I'm a parent at Graham, or I'm, you know, a community person and I belong to the local Kiwanis chapter or whatever. It will give people a chance to know who you are that don't already know you. We have a list of everyone that said yes that we'll give you in a bit. But why don't we start just so that as you're moving through the next portion of the evening, if there's somebody you're saying, aha, that's who that name goes with, let me just stop and say hi to them. So maybe we'll start way at the back, just for fun. And to catch people off guard, name and role.
Hello, my name is Kate Casper. I am the interim assistant superintendent of special services here in Avondale. I have been in the district for many years. I was principal at Graham, and then I became special ed director. I retired, and I was asked to come back when Karen Olas left in January. So I'm here till June, I think. But I'm very happy to be back. I'm happy to be in the process too.
Wonderful.
Hi, my name is Larry Wesley, and like Kay, I'm also retired from a different occupation. However, I've been with the Avondale Schools now in the Human Resources Department for 4 years, so I have been in a pretty good record here. I am a part-time person. I don't work every day. So I work with Phyllis Fairbairn and Mrs. Glass, who does our benefits. I like being here.
Hi, I'm Marcia Hudson, and I'm not retired. Maybe at some point, but I'm celebrating my 29th year in the district, and most of the time I spent teaching first or second grade at Auburn Elementary. But I also have taken a role to work with elementary literacy, and I also work with the partnership. So you'll hear a little bit more from me in a few minutes.
I'm Martin Ballard. I'm instructor at the high school. I was here 17 years ago, and I got to come back this January, and I'm thrilled to be here.
I'm Steve Suker. I'm a familiar face to most of you. I'm on the Board of Education for the school district.
Hi, I'm Sharon Hyde, and I'm principal at the high school. I was assistant principal last year, and that's stepped into this position this year.
Doug Wilson, assistant principal at the high school. Came from the west side of the state, and west to join the community.
Hi, Frank Lambs, the assistant superintendent for finance. And I've been here officially 5 years, but a year before that, I was working with Avondale, but actually working with Fort Charles.
Hello, everyone. I have two roles in the district I grew up. One is I'm an Avondale dad. I'm an eighth grader at Avondale Middle School and fifth grader at Deerfield, and I'm also privileged to be the principal of Deerfield Elementary.
Hi, everybody. My name is Vicki Moga. I'm a Deerfield parent. I have a fifth grader. She's 10 years old. I also have a 26-year-old and a 23-year-old who came through the district. So I'm a lifer.
Wonderful.
Kathy Bomberito. I have two roles. I've got children in the district. I'm a big person. That's the type this year. I'm on the hill. I have a ninth grader, boy, and a girl in sixth grade. This is my 17th year teaching, and I've taught sixth grade every year.
Hello, my name is Julie Drake, and I'm a parent of Woodland. I have a fourth grade girl and a fifth grade girl.
I'm Andrea Marino, and I am a third grader at Woodland.
I'm Julie Boyd. I have a kindergarten boy at Woodland and a fourth grade girl.
Hi, my name is Susan Good. I have a son who's a sophomore at Avondale High School, a seventh grader at Middle School Brian, and a fourth grader Connor at
Woodland. My name is Dan and Holly. This is my seventh year in administration. I am the proud principal of Avondale Middle School, and this is my first year, and I definitely felt welcome being here. Thank you.
Peggy McConnell, I've been in the district 24 years. I have two older children that graduated from Avondale and have great experience in Avondale, and I run the visiting program and the rentals.
Hi, I'm Colin C. I work with Avondale Assistants. I'm also a lifer. My kids graduated from Avondale, and I just saw that we run some after school programs, and I feel like we're a good support agency for the district to help continue.
Hi, I'm Jody Berger. I'm at middle school, my third grade middle school, but I started the high school. I assumed taught in 86, came back in 89, and I've been there ever since, so, you know, 20 plus years of high school and now middle school, so I've seen tremendous change in the district, and I love every minute of it, and I love the direction of everything.
Hi, I'm Molly Abbott. I'm a product of Avondale, so I've been here since 91, and I teach first grade at Auburn.
I'm Angel Lau. I have a daughter in middle school, but there's a whole lot of Laos in the district. My husband was class of 90, and we returned to raise our family here. I have a nephew at a high school, another nephew at a middle school, and I have two nephews at the elementary school. So we're kind of taking over. I'm also a volunteer with the youth assistants. I sit on the board. My role there is family education. And I also sit on the advisory council for Oakland County Youth Assistance for the Family Education Advisory Council.
Hi, my name is Bonnie Kakuda. I have a third grader at Auburn. I have a seventh grader and a ninth grader.
Hi, my name is Candace Sirkman. I have kids graduated in 2006 and 2007 and 2013.
we have. And so I have two children.
Wonderful. Sir?
I'm in Bart, parent of a fifth grader from Woodland. By profession, I'm a design manager with Rosen North America, which is a German automotive supplier up in Avondale.
And we have a couple people that came in, and we already went by your row, so please.
Yes, I can. Hello, everyone. My name is Donald Johnson. I have four amazing daughters and a lot of gray hair.
Well, just wait.
Just getting started. Well, actually, one's in college, a second year George Mason. Three here in Avondale. Lead the movement called Calling on Dads. It's a Calling on Dads initiative to connect, collaborate, and contribute, and talk more about that too. But also I serve as a member of the Public System Advisory Committee at the University.
Wonderful.
My name is Jamie Brooks. This is my first year in the district. I'm the assistant principal at the high school.
BJ and Tony.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is BJ McCabe. I'm a proud principal here at Auburn Elementary School. So I kind of feel like a semi-co-host. So welcome, everybody. Glad you're here.
I'm Tony here. Been here a long time.
Nothing wrong with that.
Yeah. I'm the principal at Graham, but I started at the high school, so I'm going to forget about that. Welcome.
And a former parent.
Former parent.
And a little bit about me, not much, not this much. I worked in public ed for a long time in a school district on the other side of town. I was a teacher leader and a school principal and worked in central office and have a tremendous regard for what strong communities like Avondale provide for their children, hope for their children, and how they want to plan for their children's future successfully. So it's a pleasure to be here to be part of your process as well as help that along the way. So with that in mind, there's a gentleman that just is getting his name tag at the back of the room. Not to call you to our attention, but we don't want to leave you out of the introductions. Would you like to tell us who you are, please? Thank you so much. A lot of parents with a lot of kids who have vested interest in the room, different ages, people from the community, people that have had children graduate, which is a wonderful perspective, people who have been on the staff for a while, people new to the staff, parents who have been very active in different aspects of the community and supporting the schools. You have a wonderful team of people who can help plan for the district's future. We're going to be looking at our aspirations, what we want this school district to be 5, 10, 15 years down the road, how we're going to get there, and then the kind of beliefs that underpin those things being more likely to occur. Because there's a wonderful way as you move through your work and your decisions to have different touchstones that you go back to from time to say, is this a match for what we say we believe? Is this a match that's going to get us in terms of our spending or our priorities or our professional development, going to get us to the place that we're aiming to get? Because if you don't know where you're going, who knows where you'll end up? If you do know where you're going and you have a plan to get there, the likelihood of success goes up dramatically. So let me tell you a bit about what this process looks like. It's going to feel like you have turned your head over to its side and all kinds of things are being poured into your ear. Hopefully they will dance around in the frontal lobes in your head as information that becomes very useful for you to help make some decisions and to think along during this process. We want you to know a lot about the school district in terms of the learning results, community support, the kinds of priorities that there have been funding for, the things in the school improvement work that folks are really focusing on, pieces that are part of the HR puzzle, the financial puzzle. So again, you get a 360 view of the district operations, which will again help with the decision making. This evening and session two are designed to give you that information so then you can act on that as we start to look at what might those goals and plans be that are going to accelerate the likelihood and actually get the district to that preferred future that's in the vision and in the mission. That will be a third session. If we need a fourth session, we'll take it. We're going to get some feedback after that from the community to see what they might think. That's likely to take place on in an electronic format on the website. We'll see if we also want to have some community forums for that dialogue. You're going to have a chance to step back and look at that feedback before we formalize some recommendations that will be presented to the Board of Education in their spring meeting we anticipate in May. So it can have the endorsement and support of the Board of Education as they close the official school year's worth of meetings off in June. And things will have a red carpet spread across the summer so that as plans need to be activated over the summer, they're laid out, and certainly as school starts. So we have some days of information, we have some days of planning and determining what the goals are going to look like and what the top priorities are. We have a chance to step back, reflect, step back in and refine, and then a chance to pass it along to the Board of Education again for their review and endorsement. So in a nutshell, in a small paragraph, is a very quick summary of a lot of thinking, a lot of talking, a lot of planning to create the actions that will matter tremendously to it making a success as we look ahead. So with that, I don't think there's anybody else that's walked in that we need to introduce. So let me go ahead and ask you to do this for just a quick moment. One of the things that's always interesting is how we shape a process, and you've heard a little bit about what that looks like. We're going to have some days to think and learn and then plan. But then what it is that is in your mind that's going to make it look like success? For me, it's going to look like success if when we're done, the notebooks that you're going to get tonight are going to have some more information in them. There's going to be a lot of notes. There will have been a whole lot of conversation, and there will be some information in terms of recommendations that are going to go to the Board of Education. But that is going to be the physical evidence of what you aspire for this district to do and be for its children. I have one son. He's all grown up. That's the good news. There is that opportunity that comes as we raise our children. And as I look at what his school experience was, I know there were some things that mattered tremendously for his success. And you know with your own children, we know with the students in our classes, there are some things that matter tremendously for their success. Those are the kinds of things we want to talk about, think about, and put as priorities because our goal is for students to be successful. So travel with me for just a moment. We're going to get in the DeLorean, pop up the gull wing, jump right in. We'll turn on the windshield wipers, whatever that would look like in a DeLorean with a wonderful gull wing. And we're going to go back to the future because in 10 years, this plan will have unfolded. And 10 years from now, there will be people who are saying, you know, that team got together back in 2016. We've moved through their plan. We've moved through their recommendations. We've done some refinement and revision and extension. Because this is not something that gets cast in stone and sits still. And we're going to celebrate because we have done so many things even better than we were doing them. That the learning in the district is continuing to go in this direction. We are attracting new families. We are retaining families. Our graduates are moving on to the kinds of futures that they hope for and their parents are planning for. What would that look like to you? I'm curious. What does success look like for you when you think about what this process is going to end up with? Yes, sir.
So today, when I moved into Rochester a couple of years back, and then people ask, oh, you go to Rochester School District? I'm like, no, I go to Avondale School District. They're like, oh, Avondale School District. Now, where I want to be is when I say they should be like, wow, Avondale School District. So that's where I want to be, and that's where I see us going.
People celebrating and being very proud because of the quality of what's here. I have gotten to know Avondale in the 3 years since I have been working with the school district. I retired from another school district, came and got lucky enough to be part of the partnership. I have heard Avondale described as the best kept secret because of the quality instruction. I can tell you I've seen it. Having been in classrooms, met with teachers, having listened to the aspirations of the administrative staff as I've gotten to know them, looked at the teacher leadership work. Your teacher leader lab is known all over the region But if others don't know about it, we've got some work to do. So telling that story and have people understanding the Avondale success and why, that's a good one. What else?
Best kept secret is like nails on a chalkboard.
Right.
Everybody knows that's one of my pet peeves, because in this environment, you can't keep secrets.
Right.
If you're doing something well and you're excelling and you've got state-of-the-art programming, keeping it a secret is that your nemesis. You've got to get out there. You've got to market that. You've got to get that word out there so that more and more folks can take advantage of those types of opportunities. So the whole notion of best kept secret, I'll say, has not helped the district in recent years, particularly with the competitive environment for students that we reside in. That's something that we are changing.
I can tell you, because I teach students, graduate students in the educational leadership programs over at the university from all over the region, the buzz about Avondale among the teacher educator community is substantial. In terms of the teacher education programs for undergrads that are in Auburn and other buildings, because of your teacher lab work, because you have such high quality professional development with teacher lab that's going on here that people hear about, people are talking about you in very positive ways. But if people don't understand outside the education community, we've got some work to do. So thanks for that, please.
Well, I'd like to see people know more about how in our district, we're one of the least segregated districts in Oakland County, if not the Tri-County area. Mm-hmm. I mean, you have Hamtramck, but they're having to talk to each other in a language they don't know. In Oakland County, out in Ferndale, which is, you know, pretty racially mixed, but not religiously mixed. And Avondale is amazing. I've loved being here all these years to see the kids grow together. And you haven't heard of, I'm interested in things I could talk to you about from 1992, but you haven't heard of fights and Black against White or tremendous amounts of discrimination after 9/11. And I was at the high school and we did a huge assembly about Arab Americans after 9/11. And I mean, it's just the awesome things we do. I want people to say, oh, Avondale, they're a model for the U.S. They're a microcosm of the racial groups in the U.S.
Well, they certainly are. I mean, that's one of the things that we pride ourselves on is our sense of diversity in this district. It's very, very few communities in this state that have the range of diversity that we have in this community. And that's something to really celebrate. It's a microcosm of the workplace. It really is.
And the world.
If you're looking for a place to send your child that is going to be the most like the world of work they're going to be going into, in terms of having to work with folks different from themselves, this is it. This is it. And I think the way that we go about that, in terms of harnessing that diversity and using that diversity within our instruction, within our leadership attributes, particularly through secondary, I think it sets our kids apart from others in terms of their preparedness for success in the workplace.
So you've heard two different ideas of what that preferred future is. People recognize Avondale for the quality of what's happening in its schools, the quality of the learning, the quality of the teachers, and the quality of the environment that's welcoming, and is a way that, as a community, the school district residents support each other, and the schools reflect the wonderful opportunities to know a lot of different kinds of people. Anybody else have something in their thought bubble they want to pop out? Please.
What I took away from the Saturday strategic planning was, I don't know the gentleman's name, but he was talking about, he basically called us college snobs, and he said to be open to the school to work programs because we're shorthanded on welders, we're shorthanded on the house builders, and how we've totally gotten rid of all those kinds of programs, and now those programs are where they're making lots of money, but we don't have the people there to do the jobs.
She's referring to Dr. Kevin Corcoran, who is one of the people on the panel. He's dean of the College of Arts and Sciences at the university, and he had a lot of very compelling things to say, as did the other speakers that day. Anybody else have something in their thought bubble that is bursting to be known? Okay, I'm not going to come find you because this cord only stretches so far. during the course of the afternoon and evening, we may ask this question again, because part of this is also to fulfill your hopes and dreams about what the school district is, and we're going to have a better sense of what those building blocks are as we move through the work that we're going to do tonight. Let me just ever so briefly mention that at some point, not yet, there is going to be a notebook of information, and we didn't want you to balance too many things on your lap at once. And so that will be coming. There's a list of people who signed up to be on the strategic planning team that you'll also find something that will be helpful. And before we start the presentations just a short bit, just want to cue you into what you're going to find inside the notebook. There is a wonderful sheet that I will have to go over here to grab a copy of. That looks like this. By the way, Avondale is known for the quality of the teaching in the classroom because the teachers use a variety of thinking routines. We want to make sure you have a routine to think with, along with, and as part of this process. So tonight, as we're moving through the presentation, if you have some questions, jot them down in the left-hand column, and we'll find a way to get some answers to you. Or if you find you need some more information in the right-hand column, as your thought bubble lights up and you say, we're not talking about that tonight, but that would be really helpful for us for our decision-making, jot that down in the right-hand column. So you will have this available to catch your good ideas. And Annette, could you pop up the norms for the evening? These will come as no surprise. I call them agreements, and it's part of having been a teacher for 287 years, not even dog years. The notion that we want to just set the stage with this, we plan to begin and end on time. Tonight, first time rescheduled, we started a few minutes late. But our plan is to begin and end on time and respect the fact that you're going to be here to do that. We're going to work very hard to stay very focused on the most important things for this process. We'll have an agenda so you know what the process is going to look like. It's in your notebook for this time and next time. We're going to try to keep the focus very clearly on what's best for all of the students in Avondale schools. It's not enough for this slice, or this slice. We're talking about everyone. And that's one of the wonders about public education in our country. Whoever walks through the door, we are responsible for. And that's who we're planning for. We're going to ask that as things are unclear, you jot your question down or ask it, because we want everyone to stay engaged. And if there are things that aren't making sense, we want to get those cleared up right away. We're going to ask that you not only have a view where you're looking a lot of information in front of you, but also you can step up to the balcony a little bit and look down and say, I see some patterns here. Or that makes me think of a question I want to ask. So we're going to be looking at data, turn it into information, and then also make that be a valuable perspective that we can use in planning. And again, we're looking at the organization's overall success so that when we get to the end, the commitment that we're going to be able to make as a group, that is, we send this off to the Board of Education, we're giving them the product of our best thinking. And we have commitments that we would want them to endorse, that it's going to bring the reality of having a school district that is an incredible place for students to learn, one that is well-known and well-regarded, to your point, sir, and whatever other goals that you determine you want to achieve. Is there anything else that's missing from that list you think it's important to get out? I know what I was going to do. I was going to reach in my pocket and make sure my cell phone was turned off. And I would encourage you all to do the same, if you would, so that we don't wonder whose phone is ringing in the middle of all of this. Hopefully nobody will have something that's terribly important. So with that, we have slid down several places on the agenda. We've talked about an overview of the process. We've talked about what it might look like at the end, and we've talked a bit about norms. Anything you want to add before
we I just want to recap on a point that was made earlier, Dr. Klein, with the strategic plan. This is, at the end of the day, this is a strategic plan that is created by the community, it's owned by the community, and it's going to be implemented by the educational community. This is not my strategic plan, it's not administration's strategic plan, it's everybody's strategic plan. What the information we're all going to receive in these data notebooks and the presentations are going to be the information and some of the feedback from the community that has spoken thus far in terms of some of those major improvements, major new initiatives, those types of things that folks feel are important in moving forward. Those are things for us to really juggle, prioritize, rationalize, and put toward a plan. Because at the end of the day, again, this is a community-owned initiative. And that's, I think, what makes this process so powerful.
I'll close this part of the conversation with this little piece of information that some of you may recall from when you took U.S. history or have read or thought about the power of public education. Northwest Ordinance is something that I talked in one of the graduate classes I teach a bit about, because it's one of those pieces of our country's history that put in place the public education system that you are all a part of right now as a parent and as a community member. But way back in the late 1700s, as the Northwest Territories, which is where we are sitting right now as part of it, were created, there was a decision made that there was going to be land set aside for public education in every particular area. 1/16 of the land is going to be set aside for schools. It's a 220-some-year-old tradition that you are part of the unfolding of the next step for. Public education at that time was seen as something that was a strong responsibility to prepare people to be well-educated citizens and to live productive lives. And here you are being part of that wonderful chain of opportunity to create that future for the students here in Avondale. And with that, are we ready to push the pause button for a minute?
I think we are.
Okay.
Yep.
Would you like to invite them to dinner?
No. Okay, I'll invite you to dinner. We do have some sandwiches, chips, pop, all kinds of stuff to kind of help with the grumbles of your stomach. I'm sure all of you have had a hard, long day before coming. So we want to kind of take a break at this point so folks can get food. There are tables, certainly. You can eat out over there. You can eat at your seat. Kind of take a few minutes to get to know each other, touch base, have some informal dialogue. We're going to take maybe, about 10 minutes, thereabouts, to eat, and then we'll kind of regroup, and then we're going to get going on the data portfolios and the presentations. So we'll break now, grab something to eat, get to know each other a little bit, and then we'll regroup.
Yes. Make sure when you sit down you have your notebook and the sheet of people that are on the team, and then as you open your notebook, look for that sheet that's right near the front that has room for questions and I need more information, so you can be jotting that as we move along.
I'm going to pass around pencils. If you need one, just grab one out of the box.
Inside the front of your notebook, on the left, inside the left cover, is the agenda for the evening. And just because there's something very special awaiting students called Mr. Pagel reading a story, we're going to flip the order just a little bit so that he can change out of his principal suit and into his reading costume.
PJs.
PJs.
Mm-hmm.
While you're getting settled, let me just tell you one great question was asked as you were walking over to dinner. Anel had asked me, he said, when we get to the end, what is the plan going to look like? And that's a really important question. Well, we'll move ahead, obviously, through some priorities, and we'll look at the vision for the district, we'll look at the mission, we'll look at the beliefs. But when we're done, we're going to have a plan that has actionable items with costs associated, with timelines
just
connected, and who's going to be responsible. Because it's not designed to be a trophy that's going to go on a shelf. It's going to be a plan of action that will guide the district's work, be updated as it goes along, and you'll be able to tell how well we're doing at getting our goals accomplished by the measures that are taking place along the way. So know that that's what at the end it's going to look like. We've got a format that we'll be introducing you to, not tonight, but at another one of your meetings, so you can see what that format looks like. So thank you so much for that question. Everybody have a notebook? And if you have your notebook and you have your questions and need more information, we're ready to roll.
As you have your notebook, just before we jump into presentations, just to orienteer you real quick to your notebook, on the inside cover, you will see the agendas. The agenda for tonight and the agenda for next Thursday night. So you can see, although we may deviate in the order of some of those presentations, again, as we talked about earlier, the focus of today, the focus of next week is really sort of a data dump. You know, it's really the state of the district address, department by department, area by area, to give you information about the current state of, you name it, curriculum, assessment, finances, all of those things. So you'll see in all those presentations for day one, day two, behind that sheet is the sheet for if you have questions or if you want further information to document there, and we can make sure we have that for you. And then there is a, behind the first page that is three ring binded, is the table of contents. And you can see there are essentially 10 sections, each with a tab, that we'll go through and house data for, again, each of those areas, departments, and so forth. Now, you have a bulk of the information that we'll be going over tonight. There'll be some further information that will slide into your binders, we'll have ready for you next week, but they'll fit in these 10 sections. So that just gives you kind of a table of contents as to what types of data you'll find in this notebook. Okay, questions about the notebooks or about the agendas before we springboard from here? Everybody kind of has a sense of what their notebook, how it's organized? So behind each tab, there'll be a PowerPoint presentation, most typically, and also that there'll be data reports that maybe some of those PowerPoints refer to. So you'll see that housed under each tab for each area. So on the agenda for tonight, we're gonna move up our principal's presentation because we have some events that folks need to get to. Mr. Pagel's got to run to an event at his school. And so for the sake of time, we're gonna kind of move his up and have the principals present to you. And their presentation is really to kind of put some of the major goings on in each of the areas, elementary, middle, high school, that are occurring right now. Taking a look at what education looked like maybe when we went through and how it's different today in terms of what kids are doing in classrooms. To give you a perspective of maybe how education has changed a little bit since when we were all students in those levels. So they're gonna present that to you, talk a little bit about cultures of thinking. Cultures of thinking is a big initiative we have in the district. It's strongest right now at the elementary level, and it's growing dramatically at the secondary level. And then at the secondary level, primarily they're doing learning targets, and they're gonna talk to you about what learning targets is relative to instruction. So with that, I think at this point, I'm gonna turn it over to Mr. Pagel, who's going to start us with elementary.
Thank you, Dr. Schwarz. Thank you, everyone, again, for coming out and braving the elements this evening. Again, my name is John Pagel, and I'm the biggest kid and the principal at Deerfield Elementary, and my tag team partner for the evening and co-host.
Again, good evening. My name is BJ McCabe, and I'm the principal right here at Auburn Elementary. So again, welcome.
And so our charge this evening, as Dr. Schwarz mentioned, is to kind of give you a little bit of insight into some of the work that we are doing at our favorite elementaries here in the district, and then to hopefully spur on some of your thinking and ideas so that together we can make a strategic plan that will impact student learning and achievement in the future of Avondale. So with that, our purpose and objectives for our presentation tonight. First, we want to share some perspective on recent changes and trends in elementary education, things that we've been working on. And then we'd like to set the stage for strategic planning initiatives that will support student learning into Avondale 2020 and beyond. And our objectives for our presentation, we're going to take a little walk down memory lane and try to make some connections to our own elementary experiences briefly. Review some of the current research that our team has been working on and how it impacts student learning, and to share a few of our new strategies and practices that we think are really having a deep impact on student learning. And at the end, we're going to wrap things up by reminding ourselves while we're here. So with that, by way of a connector, often in our schools, we have students have conversations with either table partners or, in this case, elbow partners around a certain topic. So by way of a connector, we're going to ask you to turn and talk real quickly to an elbow partner in your row or nearby about what you see going on in this picture. Now, I was very hurt and offended when Mr. McCabe asked me if this was, in fact, my third grade classroom, and I was sitting in the back row.
I thought I saw you.
That is not me, but it is an example of some classrooms that maybe we have been a part of in our past. So take a look and have a conversation real briefly about what you see going on in the classroom, maybe the structure of the room, and how you think students are learning in this picture. And we'll come back in just a couple of seconds. So we'll take a few brave feedback, and then I'm going to flip to the next slide, and you can just jump right in. Okay, so if the person who's talking could finish their thought. Do we have any brave people out in the audience who want to share some things that they noticed? Mr. Harris?
The connection today is still, we got artifacts still on the wall that's showing student work. Mm-hmm. I'll just say once, so I want to be nice and share with people tonight. Mm-hmm. Cool.
I can go off of that. I do see the work on the wall, but I see it's all very organized looking, and the desks are all in rows, and it all looks pretty much the same. Some kids are wearing the same kind of hat. Mm-hmm. There's just some uniformity in it. Mm-hmm.
At least most of the kids are engaged. They are doing something that the teacher is trying mm-hmm. to teach, except a couple of them are a little distracted.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
That never happens in our classrooms now.
There's nothing, there's no papers on the desk. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Let you know they're paying totally attention to the teacher.
Well, and that's an interesting point, because what I see when I look at this, it reminds me of my elementary classroom, where the teacher stood always at the front of the classroom, or most of the time at the front of the classroom, and was sort of the god or goddess or guru of the content. And they would present this content to students who were sitting in rows, and the students would ingest that content, and it was a sort of a one-way style of communication, and students very neatly in those rows and so forth, and a teacher was often judged as being a great teacher or having a very organized classroom if you walked into that classroom and it was nice and quiet, and there was great control, and one person was talking at a time. So contrast that.
Well, because if it was quiet, how could the students not possibly be learning, right?
That's right.
So that was then, and we have some images for you. This is now, okay? Now we see in today's schools, students are engaged in a variety of media. Students are being asked to talk with each other about that media, whether it be technology, whether it be a reading passage, whether it be a mathematical word problem. Students are often encouraged to get up, walk around, engage in whatever it is that is in front of them. So it's often great as an administrator to walk into a classroom where there's kind of like this buzz in the room, if you will, of learning. And that happens on a daily basis in our elementary buildings where we walk in, and it's certainly not the quietest classroom in the hallway, but you can tell just by walking around and looking and seeing what the students are engaged in and what they're talking about, that there's a great deal of learning that is happening in our elementary schools.
So much more emphasis on collaboration. One of our colleagues, Dr. Lauren Childs at Oakland Schools, often coins the phrase that thinking is messy. Thinking can be really messy, and in the very best way. And so I think these pictures sort of illustrate that. You know, another example of classrooms then and now can be depicted here in this depth of knowledge wheel. If you take a look at the way that the wheel is divided, level one is this notion of recall, where students are introduced to factual knowledge and content, and they recite, they define, arrange, or they memorize, and then share knowledge back on a test that might be matching or that sort of thing. And so if you had a great teacher, and I had many great elementary teachers, we spent an awful lot of time in this level one recall section of the depth of knowledge wheel. And if you had a really amazing, exemplary, outstanding teacher, you might get into some work here, skill development, level two kinds of things, where we're classifying and graphing, doing some interpreting and certainly some predicting with regards to stories and plot development and things of that nature. And what we're trying to do with students now is to move them and their interaction of content into levels three and four, which the focus word in describing each of these is thinking, strategic thinking, extended thinking. Much of what we used to memorize and work with in level one can now be found on this little thing that many of us are carrying around all the time. So if you were a person who had trouble memorizing your states and capitals, and sort of regurgitating those onto a test for your teacher. Now, if you need to know what the capital of Idaho is, and you might not know right off the top of your head, you can get it here in about 2 seconds, along with a whole host of other content. What's important now is what we're doing with the content and how we're interacting, having students interact and collaborate around content in levels three and level four. And we've been developing in Avondale in particular strategies and routines around making students' thinking visible, ensuring that we've got equal collaboration with students working in groups but with specific roles that rotate to ensure participation from everyone. Thinking is messy and can be really messy, and it can be a little bit noisy, and yet the perspectives that we have with our diversity that we bring to all of those learning conversations really allows us to get into levels three and four, and we'll come back to that. As an administrative team, we've been doing some work around the research of Dr. Richard Elmore out of Harvard University, and Dr. Elmore talks about this notion of an instructional core. And he describes the way to impact real, true educational change that will impact student achievement. In order to do that, we must impact equally all three vertices of the instructional core triangle. We must impact how the student learns and how they interact and engage with content. We must impact and improve the content itself and be able to manipulate that to make it challenging and thought-provoking. And we must impact how the teacher interacts and does instruction with students. And so this notion of standing up in front and presenting material to be ingested and then hopefully memorized and returned has now moved to this notion of what are we going to do with the content? How are we going to take factual information and skills that we have that we've worked on in class and now apply them to deeper analyzing and solving of problems in the real world? And so this notion of the teacher, the student, and the content all being worked on at the same time. And we've done a lot of work on that in Avondale, and our hope is that the work of this group together will help us to strategize new ideas and develop new programs that will help to push this even further.
So we're going to wrap up our time together talking about Dr. Ron Richard, who is a researcher out of Project Zero, Harvard Graduate School. He's been researching out of there since 1994. And you've heard also already this evening from Dr. Klein about this notion of thinking routines. You have a thinking routine that she introduced to you that we're asking you to write on. Over on the windows, there are some thinking routines on display, some of which from Mrs. Abbott's own first grade class. All of the staff in Avondale are engaged in learning more about the work that is coming out of Project Zero and Dr. Richard. And we're going to start with this brief video.
Today's world, what we really want from students is I think a great deal of flexibility and ability to look at the world, to be inquisitive about that, to be able to see and define problems in that, and to be able to deal with them in very creative ways. The ability to take perspectives, to look at things from lots of different angles, is becoming more and more important as we, you know, become a global world, and children have more and more opportunities to see how the world influences them and to look at things from different perspectives, and we need to develop that in our classrooms. So a big part of the student becoming a thinker is that ability to look at different perspectives, to find problems, to be curious, and then to be able to follow up on that curiosity, to be able to direct one's own inquiry and one's own understanding. When I think about creating a culture of thinking and where that's worked in my career and how that theme has been picked up, it's really come from my experience as a teacher, that as a teacher I thought that the biggest challenge I had was about getting kids to think. That although I was very interested in curriculum and designing interesting lessons and activities, I knew that it had to be more than that, that I really had to work with kids over the course of a year about how do we build relationships, how do we work together as a group to really develop our thinking and understanding. So it was always a part of my own teaching. And then as I began to work with more and more teachers about teaching for understanding, I saw that this was also a huge need of teachers, that it wasn't just about the lessons, those were very important, but also it was about the culture in which those lessons get taught. And so in order to have a more supportive atmosphere, something that can really make understanding take off, the culture of thinking is an important ground.
So that's what the teachers here in Avondale are committed to creating that culture of thinking, not only with the students that we see each day, but also with the adults. And we could honestly spend the rest of our time this evening, we could spend the rest of our time next week talking about just Richard's work and creating a culture of thinking. But a couple key things that come out of that are this notion of routines. Again, you've been asked to do a routine. There's several routines on display, not only here in the windows, but if you were to walk the hallways of Auburn, of Deerfield, of Graham, of Woodland, you would see evidence of thinking routines, students' thinking being visibly displayed on these different routines. One of the things I always ask my second grader when we're eating at the dinner table, I ask him, well, how was your day today? And he always will give me, yeah, it was okay, or not so good. And traditionally, parents might have just left it at that, but But I further that and I say, well, what makes you say that? And that's a key phrase that you'll hear many staff members here in Avondale at the elementary, middle, and secondary schools say is, what makes you say that? And just by flipping it back and asking that question back to our students and to our children, it brings up to the surface more of why they're thinking the way that they're thinking.
One of the cultural shifts that we are starting to see in our buildings and in our classrooms is that when we ask students a question, they almost always follow it up with, because. And the reason for that is because we continue to ask over and over, and they know it's coming. And so that should be happening at home as well. And so when you talk to your students and you ask them about anything, they should be following that up with a because to share their thinking around whatever topic it is that you're talking about.
Dr. Richard helped publish this book, Making Thinking Visible. I will keep this here. If you're on a break and you want to peruse the book, I'll leave it here. And his most recent publication is this notion of cultures of thinking and the fact, if you want to advance the slide, John, that there are at all times in at each classroom, whether it be an elementary, a middle, or a high school classroom, there are eight forces that are always at play. And if we as educators can learn to leverage, not all of them at the same time, but depending on what the lesson is, maybe leverage one or two of these forces, it would enhance the students' learning and we would be getting better products from the students if we were to leverage these forces. And there are many buildings in the district that are working together as an adult community, looking at this book and looking at the eight cultural forces more in depth.
You know, one of the things, just to go back to the depth of knowledge wheel, one of the things that really struck me as a dad, I'm already very uncomfortable with this notion that when my two boys are ready to go into the workforce, that they are most likely to have multiple career changes, many career changes in their short time of work. That is very unsettling to a person who's been a teacher and then subsequently an educational administrator and has essentially had one career and very little change. But one of the things that struck me when Dr. Schwarz came around to present to our building communities was this word here in level four and this notion of create and another reason for the importance of the eight cultural forces, the importance of making thinking visible, because our students are going to need to create their own occupation opportunities moving forward. Not only will they have career change, but they are going to be responsible for doing the thinking and problem solving to create their own jobs. And that's very unsettling for someone like me, who was pretty good at memorizing things, who was pretty good at math algorithms and being able to carry my ones and so forth and get the right answer, but never really understood the number sense that was behind what was going on in that math problem. And I want my sons to be able to create their own jobs moving forward. And I think that is one of the main challenges for this strategic planning team, which brings us to kind of our closing slide. And why are we here? Well, we're here because each of these strategic planning subcategories that maybe you've expressed an interest in being a part of planning impacts the instructional core. In some way, it's going to impact the content, the curriculum that our students are going to be interacting with to ensure that it's challenging. It's going to impact the role of the teacher and his or her instructional practices in order to bring that content alive. And it's going to impact the way that students interact with content, with the way that they interact with each other, and to give them the gift, the ability to think, to solve problems, and to ultimately create their own occupations moving forward. So we look forward to the challenge of all that, and we're asking for your help, because behind each one of these logos are either hundreds or thousands of students that are relying on us to prepare them for Avondale 2020 and beyond. So thanks for being a part of making that possible.
And John, if I might just add, I've been very fortunate to have been working in Avondale for 3 years now, but prior to that I worked in a neighboring district for 10 years. And never once in that decade of that neighboring district have we done, had they done anything like what we're doing here tonight. So I'm excited to be a part of it. Thank you again for being here, and I'm just looking forward to seeing what direction these types of conversations take us. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Hopefully some of this is going to look very familiar, and there might even be information here that your students can come home and talk to you about one of these days. It can happen to middle schoolers and their parents. It really can. Mr. Halleck.
So it goes back to that question. When you pick your children up from school and you inquire, you say, hey, what did you learn today in school? Good question. At the middle school, we tend to lead with learning targets. So when our students answer that question, they talk about the learning targets that they were exposed to in school. In every class, the teachers have a different learning target for the students that they are teaching. Who remembers the acronym on the board when you were in school? SWBAT. Anybody remember that? SWBAT, nobody knows the name, nobody? When I was in school, I would go in, when you went into the classroom, you always saw it on the board, it was students will be able to, and then there was an objective. Every teacher had an objective, what? But the teachers never talked to the students about what the objective was. It was always there. The objective was there for the teacher and for the principal. So for us, leading with learning targets, we want the students to know exactly what is expected of them as students. What are they expected to learn? So teachers spend time at the beginning of the class period unpacking those learning targets. So we kind of talk about learning targets being described for students as something that is shared with students every day. Teachers spend time unpacking it. It's written in student-friendly language, so students have the opportunity to inquire or ask questions if they don't understand. Teachers spend a great deal of time of probing, asking probing questions to make sure that students understand. And when you think about learning targets, you think about new concepts, how we connect new concepts with the learning targets that are being presented. Building students' knowledge, building students' understanding, and building students' capacity is what we want to do. With learning targets, you want students to take ownership for their own learning. Take ownership for their own learning. Students have an opportunity to practice a skill for accuracy, applying a skill that they already know with new content. Research. Research says that if a student knows what is expected of them, if a student knows what is expected of them, what they're supposed to learn, you'll see an increase of 20% in student success or student performance. Clear goals help students learn better when students understand exactly what they are supposed to learn. It's not enough for a teacher to plan a learning target and tell students about it once. So with learning targets, we kind of encourage and motivate teachers to kind of share that information multiple times within a lesson. So at the beginning of the lesson, teachers are sharing learning targets. At the middle of the lesson, teachers are checking for understanding, temperature checks of where students are in regards to that learning target. And at the end, whether it's an exit ticket or some form of strategy, where teachers can get a good understanding of what the students have gained. So with the learning target, this is something that I want, or I have to master as a student by the end of the class period. Shared learning. What is a shared learning target? It kind of talks about that direction. What direction are we going in? What is required of me as a student? What understanding or what level should I gain this information? They convey to students the destination of the lesson, what is to be learned, how deeply to learn it, and how exactly how to demonstrate their new learning. So whether it's an activity that's followed by the information that's being shared, students have an opportunity kind of to report out what is learned. So learning targets, when you think about learning targets, you think about engagement of students. So we kind of took a look at the picture that John and BJ kind of shared, where it was more so, the teacher was more so in front of the class and the teacher guided the instruction. With learning targets, you see more students being engaged. So when you think about the power and meaningful sharing, we want students, we want teachers to talk to students, we want students to talk to each other. So with learning targets, you see that, you see students interacting, students kind of checking their own understanding, teachers assessing themselves. Where am I in regards to the learning target? Have I mastered the learning target? What things can I do better? So you think about the growth mindset and students setting goals, not limits, with learning targets, and students pushing themselves. So from a culture standpoint, once again, we want students to take responsibility for their own learning. Designing a strong performance of understanding. When introducing the lesson, the teacher should explicitly share the learning target. So this is the unpacking of the learning target at the beginning of the lesson. And we talk about teachers doing, or students doing the heavy lifting, where you have a learning target there that's to be shared. Students know it's there because we talk about repetition. We talk about doing the same thing. We talk about routines, where the learning target is there and the students know and what to expect when they come into the classroom. And at the beginning of every hour, teachers spend time unpacking that information and sharing that information with students. So moving forward, you want every student to have a good understanding of what the learning target is. So before we move forward, we want every student in the class to know what the learning target is. What are we expected to master before we leave class today? Why should we take ownership in this? How can we push ourselves? How can we encourage and motivate others? These are some of the things that we kind of look at. So what I want to do now is kind of to take a look at a video. In the video, you actually see a teacher unpacking a learning target for students. You see the teacher asking probing questions for students.
The tip of this iceberg for this expedition, we really just have a little bit of knowledge based on our own family's immigration stories. And as we get into our expedition, we'll get into two really chunky, long-term case studies. Please take a look at today's workshop target. Give me a thumb if you have a specific notice or a wonder based on just today's workshop target. Let's make sure we understand what this is all about. See a lot of thumbs, a lot of things people are noticing, a lot of things people are wondering.
Probing questions.
Maddie, start us off. What do you see here?
We're going to use some documents or some like text to notice some wonders about case studies.
Yeah, we'll look at some different texts to create some notices and wonders. What else are you thinking about, Ben? What do you think we're going after here? What questions do you have about today's target?
The question is, what's an immigration case study?
Had that right here. Awesome. Great question, Ben. We'll come back to that in just a bit. Thanks. Andrew, something you're noticing or wanting?
We're going to add on to Maddie's.
Well, so you see there with the teacher, you saw that the teacher was not doing the heavy lift than the students were. You noticed that with the learning target, the teacher was not reading the learning target to the students. You noticed that the teacher was inquiring and engaging the students about the learning target. The teacher was checking for understanding. You saw the protocols, the 5-to-5. You saw the interaction and the engagement of the students. So at the end of unpacking that learning target, the teacher would have a good understanding of who understands what is being shared for that particular class period. So students have a good understanding of that. So learning targets. So just wanted to kind of have an opportunity to kind of share out some information. This last particular slide or video that I'm going to share at the beginning of the school year, we had an opportunity to do some work with our staff in this very room in regards to learning targets. This is probably like the first or second week of school where we had an opportunity to kind of see how teachers were presenting learning targets to students. The big part and the portion of this particular piece that I'm proud of is the onboarding of staff and the buy-in from teachers. Teachers have an opportunity to, this is a new initiative, this is something that we're gonna lead with, this is something that we're gonna share with students, this is something that we're gonna use to engage students. And it was refreshing to see that 100% of the staff was on board in regards to presenting this information on a daily basis to engage students, to motivate students, to encourage students to put forth 110%. Yeah. So that was kind of had an opportunity to kind of go into the classrooms and kind of take a look at what teachers were currently doing. This is something that occurred towards the beginning of the school year. So you notice the date on many of the actual learning targets or many of the boards. It just speaks to the buy-in from the teachers, the engagement of the students. And it's just something that we're looking to build upon. If you look at the five essentials and you talk about purpose and you talk about teachers leading with learning targets with our new tool that we're looking to adopt, that's one of the evaluation aspects of it. So teachers will share the daily learning targets on a daily basis. Students are expected to know the learning target and work to achieve it each day. Learning targets will be in I can statements. You saw that With the examples, you saw the I can't statements. That's that student-friendly language, and you definitely want to be positive. You know, this is something that you're going to master before you leave the classroom. So that growth mindset piece that we kind of talked about, this is the way for students to see if they have learned what is expected of them. So temperature checks, information is shared multiple times within the classroom. Teachers constantly revisit the learning target because that's something that you want students to master before leaving the classroom. Thank you.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
I had to check it because the students always make sure if I was looking through after six, I would say good evening, but I wanted to say good afternoon. I want to spend a few moments just to talk about past and present in the classroom. Now, as my colleagues mentioned at the elementary school level, we looked at our lecture type of classroom with the chalkboard, and things have evolved more to a group setting and more to even circling face-to-face. And why is that? Because we understand that people learn differently. In 1984, David Kolb came up with a model that talked about learning styles. And there's three types of learning styles. We have our visual, auditory, and kinesthetic. Now, seeing it, hearing it, and doing it. Now, in the lecture type of format, what was that mostly of? Mostly hearing. How many of us know our learning style? What we learn best at? Raise your hand if you do, please. Okay. And that's very important because you can only advocate for yourself if you know what type of learning style works best for you. So that's what we try to do, is encourage our young people to understand what's their best learning time. How schools have changed from when we were a kid. Forget about handwriting. And what I mean by that is that penmanship was very, very important in the past. But moving forward, penmanship is, I don't want to say less important, but used less often. Now, it is seen to be admirable. However, we're looking at typing skills being much, much more important because things are done on a computer. And research says that good penmanship won't necessarily get you a job nowadays because everything has become more tech savvy and you have to use the computer. So being able to type is a little bit more important than being able to have good, being able to write cursive or being able to right well. And I cringe to say that, but that's kind of where we're going. Cooler classrooms. In the past, we used to go to computer lab. Now we're looking at 3D printing, coding, video gaming, so things are a lot more exciting than they once were. Lighter backpacks. How many remember carrying the heavy backpacks? Now we still have some students that do that. However, there's iPads and our phones and all type of technology to gather that information. So we're slowly getting away from the backpacks and the heavy textbooks. Now they're still here, but we're working towards getting away from those. Smartphones used to be, if you bring those smartphones, you put them up. If you see them, they're going to confiscate them, and you'll get them back later. And as a matter of fact, the school district that I came from, we would confiscate them to the end of the year. So if they got it taken at the beginning, then it would be. Now, of course, there was a lot of emotional conversations. And but now there's apps on phones. There's different times. As of today, there's different times. We have red zones to where the phone is off. We have green zones to where you can use the phones. And that's during transition or in case there's a lesson that calls for it. So we're embracing technology, and it really motivates and encourages the students to be involved because they like using those phones. How has home life changed? In the past, we had one income. You had one person go out to work and the other parents staying home to make sure that the kids were taken care of, make sure they got their studies. They volunteer at school and they were very, very active and very visible. And now we're down from the National Center of Policy Analysis, two paycheck households are now the majority in the U.S. So what does that mean? That means parents are busy. Their time is limited now. That means they're not able to attend as many parent-teacher conferences. They're not able to go on as many field trips and volunteering. So it really has affected the students and the support. So where does that support come from? Because they need it. They need it. They ask for it. And it becomes the teacher's responsibility. So now the teacher has a much, much larger role. And let's not even talk about the social piece. Because what also we miss in that piece is that when the family sits home at the dinner table, that's when you really get a chance to look in your children's eyes and see how was their day. And if they can say what they want, but if you look at them in the eye, you can understand, well, what you're saying is not matching up with what you're acting. So you're able to probe and find out what's going on and how their day went. But when families are so busy now trying to make ends meet and putting that onus on the student and on those educators to do that, then when does that student get that opportunity to sit down and have that quality time that was already lacking in the past? So that's very, very important moving forward. And so technology has really changed the way students learn. Students are motivated because they like to be on the phone so much. When you give them an opportunity to do some educational things and educational apps and opportunities on the phone, then they appreciate that. And also the collaboration, working in more groups, being able to work with others as opposed to just sitting by themselves. Standardized tests. In the past, when standardized tests first started around World War I, standardized tests was IQ. Your IQ score was what you were gauged on. And now we're looking at things on Common Core. Now, if we had grade level expectations, and then we moved into Common Core. And Common Core really talks about, and it was developed by experts and teachers, but it really talks about how prepared are you for the working world, for the workforce, first year freshman in college. So it gives a more in-depth and more detailed and concrete level of confidence in reference to getting ready for the next level. So in summarizing, as things continue to evolve, we have to evolve with it as parents. Because a lot of times we get left behind. Our students are on using technology so much that when you ask them, they don't even want to teach you anymore. They just want to do it for you, and then they want to keep moving. So it puts a challenge on us as adults and parents, and as educators, we have to do. But as parents, we need to make sure that we try to stay as abreast with as technology as much as possible, because we know that students can do things, and we will never know what they're doing unless we know where to help, how to help them, and where to find information. So from that, I would like to turn this over to Ms. Hyde.
Thank you, Jamie.
You're welcome.
Good evening, everyone. At Avondale High School, we believe that every student matters. We believe that all voices matter of our students, and we also believe in strong partnerships and strong collaboration. We also are embedding the learning targets within our classrooms. We are asking students to self-assess their learning, and we are asking teachers to conduct formative assessments. You will see that in the video that has been created for you by our radio and technology students. They have created a video of the 21st century aspects and the items and the strategies that we are using within our classroom. You'll see students holding up whiteboards to show the teachers that they are learning the concepts. If they're not learning, the teacher then is able to take that data and to use that information in order to guide their instruction. In the video, you're also going to see Harkness discussions. Basically, this is students getting together in groups within a teacher's classroom so that we as educators can make sure that every student's voice is being heard. We're looking to make that thinking visible so that we know those students that understand it, and we know those students that we also have to provide extra help to. So you'll see many Harkness discussions taking place in the video that we're going to show you. You're also going to see project-based learning. We know that many of our students learn better when they are doing projects, so you'll see those taking place in the classroom. You're also going to see a great use of technology that we're embedding right into our curriculum. You'll see the radio students embedding and using all of that technology every day. In our classrooms, you're going to see that they're very busy. They're not as neat and organized as they used to be years ago. You're going to see a lot of student work on the walls so that we can make that thinking visible. So those are some of the items that you are going to see. So at this point, we're going to show you a short video that's been made by our students at Avondale High School so that you can see the learning that's taking place in the 21st century.
Our second to last day to build. I see that you guys have a lot of on your bridges. Remember that our learning target is to use the knowledge of bridge building to create the strongest bridge that we possibly can. And just to reinforce that, what's the strongest shape?
Triangle.
What should I see a lot of in your bridge?
Triangle.
Very good. Okay, go build.
All right. This is the Gus Bus Bridge. It's going to be the winner of the competition.
The main idea of this project is to build a functioning cantilever truss bridge, which is cantilevers are the triangles on the sides here, and the truss is the lower part in the middle.
We attach like a bucket and fill it with sand, and then whoever's like drops first.
Like whoever's carries the most weight gets the high screen.
Yep.
Yeah, this is like
2G.
Yeah, that's like 2G.
No,
I made it 2G.
Okay. Oh, okay, so then that has 4, so that's going to be the cantilever.
Yeah.
And then that's what it is. But you might want to make more supports in the middle.
How long
is this
going to be?
Oh, how many
times?
No, just make the top part.
Curtis's question. I think an example would be like when we watched about the benches, how in the different areas of where the beach changed in order to like even survive.
So like, why do you think this is evidence for evolution?
It can show how you can see different types of organisms and like learn more about them. And then if you start learning more about them, then shouldn't you like be able to go, like, you can go all the way back to the first ones.
I was gonna say, I feel like if the monster had a wife, that, like, he wouldn't be as crazy as he is right now. He'd kind of, like, mellow out, you know?
I agree, but then again, at the same time, like, that's a lot of work for Victor, like, he has to go through his whole process again.
He knows what he's doing now. Like, okay. When he first made the monster, he knew what he was doing.
Well, I'm pretty sure since he's going back to thinking and get more research. So, like,
that EMT was exceeded only by piety.
Get the solution for me in degrees. In 3, 2, 1, hold it up. Let me see what we got here.
Hold on, let's see what everybody got.
We got. I don't even know how I got those. Okay, and now put it in ratings. Okay, are you ready? All right, let me see your boards. Hold them up. Wow. You should have pi for the radians and quadrantal as the angle. And 3.1 for etc. is also pi. So you could have gotten.
So we had
had a project in Honors Algebra 2 where we had to create a logo based on math equations and conics. So this was our science department logo.
We created it using parabolas, circles, ellipses, and lines.
And this was supposed to be like a test tube tree for the science department. And this is basically what we did for a project for that unit. And it was a good, I mean, it was a good approach to us, and we liked the idea of learning that way, so.
So in radio class, Tristan has just finished his recording, which is his teaser, his commercial for the upcoming Friday show that we're about to do. And here I am, now having learned how to use Audacity, kind of editing, you know, the spaces in between him talking. I'm going to put some music on it so that it sounds nice and radio quality.
Some of the strategies that we're proud to be implementing at Avondale High School. We are also moving towards implementing the cultures of thinking. We know that our elementaries have gone strong with it. So at the present time, we are embedding it into our curriculum. We are beginning a book study in April so that our teachers will lead a book study and then see the routines taking place in other classrooms. So as a district, we can take a systemic approach to making sure that we are all developing a culture of thinking. And Mr. Doug Wilson will speak shortly on that.
Or I am going to talk. Good evening. We'll make this short. Just wanted to let you know, as we continue this journey, we at the high school are partaking in a book study that is going to focus on the eight cultural forces. In addition, if you have an opportunity to go into any of the elementary schools that we have here, We as high school teachers, we as high school administrators have been inspired to reach the level of cultures of thinking that has been going on at the elementary school levels. And we have been inspired to move in that direction as quickly as we can. If you turn to the second to last page in your handout, or in your book, right before section four, you'll see a handout that looks like this. It says a map for understanding. It should be the second page right before section four. Those are the questions that we are using to guide our curriculum, to guide the conversations that we are having. These questions are about ownership and understanding, not about what you know, but about what you are doing with that knowledge. And our goal is to have you walk down the hallways like you do in the elementary schools and have it look like what Mr. Ballard's class looks like when you walk down our CTE hallway, and celebrate the fact that our students are doing extremely amazing things on a daily basis with our teachers and each other. Thank you.
Questions you may have at this time about our elementary, middle school, high school? Yes.
What's your definition of harkness?
Definition of harkness. Mrs. Hyde.
Harkness discussions are student-led, and so what the teacher would do is tell them your topic is going to focus on theme or plot, and then the students are asked to contribute to that discussion, and students, then the teacher is documenting as they go through that to make sure that they are hearing every student's voice, so that they get an idea of what is the students thinking, and who are the students that I need to help.
Okay. Other questions? Does the teacher guide the discussion by moderating to make sure they are moving in the right direction?
Yes, the teacher will moderate as needed, and then follow up to that as the teacher leads a discussion based on what the students have said. So based on the students' understanding, that guides the teacher as to where they need to lead their discussion.
You talk about all the teachers guiding it up. Where does this go when it goes home to the parents? Are the teachers talking to the parents to help them at home to continue at a home of, you know, like the principal said, you know, he goes home, yes, to your kid, what they learned, oh, nothing. Well, is there a way you're getting to the parents to teach them what are some of the questions you can ask them? The teachers are helping them, so it goes home.
One of the things a lot of the parents or a lot of the teachers are doing at the middle school, when the students come in, they have the students actually physically write the learning target in the agenda. So as a parent, when your child comes home, you can have that child take that agenda out. At the middle school, in the agenda, you can see the learning targets, and you can use those learning targets as talking points in regards to what they learned.
Right, that helps at the middle school, but what about the elementary?
Right.
I can see the government.
I'll give an example. Today, now there's social studies being taught in fifth grade. I need to know that I can follow back home with my son. Okay, is this what you're learning? You know, kind of refreshes memory. But unfortunately, I don't have a book to refer to. And even on asking the school to give me a book during the break or refer me a book during the break, I don't get a response. So how can I help in building up or reinforcing what the kids learning in the school?
Okay, two things at the elementary. First thing, K through second grade, most of you receive a newsletter.
Can you hold the mic, please?
You're a teacher, right? K through second grade, throughout our district, you receive a newsletter once a week. And in that newsletter, they talk about the target goals, what's going to take place that week. You know, you get your spelling words, you get your math problems. Third grade through fifth grade is agenda that goes home on a daily basis, that have their targets, talk about their assignments that took place in the classroom. To answer your question is that when you're trying to help your son in social study or science, there's a couple things. You always can use the internet to help on that part, and you also can email that teacher if you're stuck on an area, because we check our emails on a regular basis. So we have things in place to help the parents. The key thing is for elementary parents, because we have I can statement, is to, when they come home, to ask them what took place in that classroom, okay? And if you follow the newsletter, okay, it talks about some of the daily things that's gonna take place. Will give you a good idea in terms of what's happening. Newsletter go home every Friday in a Friday folder, okay, throughout our district. And then you also will give a overview newsletter from your principal about, in particular, some of the highlights that have taken place in the school or some of the events that's coming up. Do that help?
Can I add that?
Yes.
That became very dry because we do a lot of the same things as a routine every day. So then I kind of changed over, and I think that helps kind of keep everybody up to date. And I think hopefully, more teachers at Auburn are embracing the social media aspect, so I think that might help too.
But I think there's a need to establish a standard across the different elementary, which there's a good representation from Grant, there's a good representation from Auburn Elementary, from the staff. Is there anybody from Woodland? So, and how many Woodland parents are here? And I think there's good representatives of parents, because there is a gap that you see in the standard between different elementary schools. Whereas being in a school district, I think we can establish some basic standard around. You know, this is a good aspect of things to communicate back to the parents back home, but not necessarily all the students who follow this. Right? So it's very subjective to the individual teachers, but it would be more useful if it's better standard.
And typically when you get into new initiatives like this, that's how it is. When you've got to, it takes time to corral everybody, get everybody to the same ability level around the district as a teacher and with the same communication pattern. So that's a great suggestion, and that's where we're headed. Are we there? No, we're not there. But with these types of things, it's growing. It's got, you know, it's certainly accelerated in some pockets more than others. And so, you know, we're constantly molding and shaping that as we go. So, to your point, that will be something that as we move will become more and more consistent between schools, between classrooms. Yeah. All right, well, as we continue on our agenda, we're gonna kind of go into talking about a little bit of the community conversations, which is under tab one. And just to recap a little bit about the fall sessions that we had. For those of you that were able to attend those, I think those were some great sessions that really kind of framed some of the 21st century skills that we've seen that are taking place in the district as we're moving forward. One of the biggest premises that we're going on, as you're hearing from elementary, middle, high school, that you're seeing captured in some of these initiatives as we move forward, is it's not what you know that's so important? It's what you do with what you know. That's what's most important. And we talk about the world of work, and we spent quite a bit of time in our fall sessions talking about what the world of work looks like for this generation moving forward, and it's very opportunistic. By opportunistic, we mean it's going to be one where there aren't going to be ready-made jobs for people to walk into. People are going to have to create their own jobs. They're going to have to market their own skills. Companies are moving more and more toward contracting employees, and contracting employees for specific amounts of time, for specific projects. When that time has lapsed, or the work on that project is complete, that job is done. And that person has to go off and market themselves to another project, to another company. Forecasters are saying that the typical student coming out into the workforce now will have 10 to 14 different jobs in their career. 10 to 14. The days of a person going into a 30-year career, and that's what they do for 30 years, those days have gone with our parents. They're not around. They don't exist. They're not going to exist. Our students are walking into a very competitive, a very opportunistic environment. And it's incumbent upon us to prepare them for that. Not just to be adaptable and flexible and all those soft skills that you need to have to be able to be successful in that environment, but teaching them, again, what do you do with what you know? Because just knowing it's not enough anymore. It's how do you creatively use that information? And then how do you market those skills for yourself so you get those jobs? You're at the top of those piles for those projects, for those companies. That's going to be the increasing trend. And so as you start to see some of the examples that we're showing from elementary, middle, high school about students getting involved with not just projects, but dialogues, understanding perspectives, looking at different ways to rationalize situations, that's all part and parcel of how we start to look at what we do with what we know. And you mold and shape your knowledge, and then you learn how to market that knowledge, market those niches and those skills. That's what's going to put our students on the top of those resume piles. Again, because just knowing information isn't enough for the type of work and the type of world that our children are going to be entering. So that really is the backdrop behind this strategic planning, is what are those things moving forward as a district to concentrate on that are those niches of where we get students doing things. When you look at emerging industries, engineering, huge. The last of the baby boomers are retiring. The market is going to be huge in the next several years for engineering positions in the U.S. So much so that we don't have enough Americans to fill them that are in engineering schools right now. Biomedical, biotechnical, IT, computer programmers. I mean, those occupations are exponentially just exploding. So what are those things that we need to be doing in K-12 to prepare kids for those huge emerging opportunities globally? So when we look at millennials and Generation Z, who are the kids that were born since 2000, when we look at those students, they are wired for that type of opportunistic environment because of the fact that they've basically have been working with technology since they've come out of the womb. They can multitask like this, and their mind is going just as fast. They are prime for that type of creativity, that type of learning by doing, because that's how they've set up their own networks. They do this from a very young age. And so we need to harness that. in our educational environment. So, what I want to jump into is just, we did a number of surveys this past fall along with our fall sessions. We had a large community survey where a survey was emailed to every family in the district. And I kind of want to just brush through the survey. You have a copy of it in your binder under tab one. And there's actually three sets of data under tab one. One is what I'm going to go through with you in terms of the community survey and what the community is showing to be important for us. Secondly, there's a staff survey. The staff survey was modeled much after the community survey that was distributed to staff throughout the district. So that information is in there, and it's very much, it mirrors very closely with what the results are with the community survey. And the third piece of information under tab one is the feedback that we received when I went around to the individual schools. There were 16 dates that I went around throughout the district within each building, each community in the fall. And I asked really three questions. What should we continue doing? What should we stop doing? What should we start doing as a school district? And I've tabulated all of that information. Actually, Annette tabulated all that information, and that is in the last part of your tab one as well. We're not going to be going through all of that information today. I'm going to go through with you just the community survey, but the other information certainly you can review at your leisure, because it very much mirrors what's in the community survey. If we went through all three surveys, we would go until the end of the evening with just that exercise. So, but I'm going to leave that for you to review. But we'll go ahead and go through some of the community survey. The community survey was one where, again, it was emailed to every family in the district in the months of October and November. And yeah, this was done by Cobalt Community Research, which is independent from the school district. It was a company that we had utilized actually a few years ago as well in 2012 to do a very similar community survey. They are the ones who, they're a 501c3 nonprofit, and they develop surveys and distribute surveys for corporations like Coca-Cola, AT&T, all sorts of school organizations and so on. So the information that we're going to be receiving has been tabulated by them. It was all submitted anonymously, but it gives us a lot of good information for us to go off of as we look forward to developing a plan in the district. Again, we took the survey in 2012 with some similar questions, and so as we go through, you'll see a comparison to where the results were in 2012 as to where they were in 2015. So you'll see some difference in perceptions. The scores from 2012 to now, you'll see an improvement in perception pretty much throughout. From what they were when it was distributed 3 years ago. It also has some state benchmarks that are associated, looking at statewide data compared to Avondale data. It was felt that there are several areas where the performance would have significant impact, and that was curriculum, teachers, services, and principals. Folks felt quite strongly about perceptions in each of those four areas. Pertaining to improvement, particularly since the last administration of the survey. So, again, the data was collected in October and November. It was sent out to 2,272 families. We received 750 back. which is about a 32% response rate, which according to them is fairly good for a school community response. We received a similar response rate back in 2012 when we had distributed the survey, again about a 32% response rate. So the respondents, you can see the dark blue is 2015, the light blue is 2012. And what this is saying is, where did most of the respondents come from in terms of where they had children? So you can see the high school had the greatest amount of response. Parents of high schoolers, I should say, were the greatest respondents, followed by middle school, followed by Deerfield, Woodland, Auburn, and then our Grant Graham. What these questions on the survey signified is that as families have experience with curriculum, services, teachers, principals, facilities, communication, website, and their experience with their most recent contact of an administrator or a teacher in the district, gave them a certain satisfaction value. So everything is put to a numeric in that formula. Because the outcome behaviors as folks have either a positive experience or a negative experience in those areas, it affects whether or not they remain in the district, whether they can speak favorably about the district, whether they're apt to volunteer or not in the district, participate in conferences or organizations or planning, or be involved with branding of the image of the district. So it certainly has outcomes depending on the experience of the individual in the district. So results. One of the narrative questions that was asked was, considering all the schools you've been in contact with, what practice or program should Avondale consider implementing? And there were some top themes that emerged in the responses to that question. The top themes were certainly by program. Folks felt very strongly that whatever programs we have in place, they should be quality programs. People like enrichment opportunities. They like after school. They like all the clubs. They like all of those after school activities, before school activities. Language classes. Elementary was particularly heavy with response wanting elementary foreign language. Didn't indicate what language, but that there is certainly a demand for elementary foreign language, according to the surveys. Folks wanted to see more college prep, more advanced course material, dual enrollment opportunities for students. Folks felt very strongly across the board about wanting those types of enhanced opportunities. As they also for special needs, more support for special needs students. Depending on their area of disability or area of need, looking for more support in that realm. As far as students go, mentoring was mentioned quite a bit in this response, wanting to see a formalized mentoring program for students. That was mostly a secondary response, 6 through 12, and activities to engage students more, be more actively engaged in the regular classroom. So when we talk about project-based learning, we talk about Socratic circles and all those types of things where students are doing and talking. That's what they're talking about, more engaging type of activities. As far as teachers go, a lot of comments about wanting lower class sizes, a lower class to teacher ratio, more communication with parents, and more of the integration of technology. So those are some major themes in terms of those areas with this particular question on that survey. Another question was, in your opinion, what are Avondale School's two best attributes? Top theme was community. Folks feel very strongly about this community, that folks like the small town feel. Folks like the fact that they know each other. that there's a great deal of camaraderie. I think that ties in with the diversity that we had mentioned earlier. But there's a very strong sense of community. People felt that that is critical. When I did the rounds around the district this fall and asked about what are those things we should be sure to continue in the district, that sense of small town feel, that sense of community, was probably the number one response. People feel very, very strong about being here, about this community. They like the fact that it's a smaller district. In fact, many folks that have come here from larger districts came here because they like the small district feel. They feel their child gets lost in a larger district. You become a number. You don't get the level of individual attention that you do in a smaller district. Those are some of the comments that were had. Teachers, folks felt by and large that we have quality teachers. They're very dedicated, they're devoted, they're friendly. Their response rate typically is quite good. Diversity was, folks feel that that was a benefit for us. Again, as we talked about earlier, economic diversity, racial diversity. Again, strengths for us to capitalize on. Contrasting the question was, what are two big improvements the district needs to make? Top themes for students were challenging students with curriculum. And that was more geared toward higher end curriculum. Again, coming back to the need from the community wanting more advanced placement opportunities, more dual enrollment opportunities, more things for a child at the higher ability level spectrum. Gifted and talented program came up several times, looking for something specifically for gifted and talented children. Also on the other end, better support for students not reaching their potential. Looking at supports and increasing those supports at the other end. Again, for disabilities and for areas of need. For teachers, again, improving class sizes, communication with parents, better accountability for poorer performing teachers, programs, beefing up our science and technology offerings, after school tutoring, having things more for the average student. Certainly those are some comments. When we talk about science and technology, so a lot of the questions revolved around STEM, wanting to see more of a formalized STEM program, and a STEM program that starts really by sixth grade. High school's too late. If you want a real robust STEM program, you gotta start it earlier. It's gotta be beginning of middle school, if not sooner. Folks felt strongly about that. Same thing with biomed, IT, biotech, those types of things. Great programs, high school's too late. A lot of stereotypes are already set in place by high school, particularly with females. So if you want to make an impression, science, math, technology, particularly on girls, you got to get them in sixth grade, seventh grade. So this is looking at just an index overall out of a 100-point scale. When we looked at the satisfaction index for 2015, the top bar, which was a 75, you know, folks by and large feel satisfied currently with Avondale schools, more so than they did in 2012, when we're at 71. Michigan, about 67% is what the typical satisfaction rate is for schools across the state, and then 65% in 2012. So when we look at outcomes, this graph kind of shows, again, the dark blue line is 2015, the light blue line is 2012. the green is Michigan overall, and the lightest blue color is the, which is medium districts across the state. So you can see in terms of participating in conferences, we have more participating in conferences than we had in 2012. It's a little less than the Michigan overall. Second column, speaking favorably about the schools. You can see those in 2015 for Avondale. Speak more favorably of the schools than they did in 2012, more so than the state, and so on. Volunteering is the next column. Participating in parent organizations, participating in school planning, and then the last one is keeping children in for the next year. How many would say they would continue and send their child again to Avondale schools next year compared to 2012, compared to the state, and so on. So you can see that we have, we still maintain a good perspective, a good perception. We certainly want that to increase. So what we said, one of the questions was about if you, why don't you get involved with schools? Why don't you get involved with planning? Simply, people don't have time. We talked about earlier, folks, two paycheck households, people don't have the time to serve in capacities to help plan or be involved with PTOs and so on like they once used to be, because the family demands have increased so much, particularly around work in the last few years. So, when we look at the school system and its image, you can see in terms of its overall image from 2012 has increased, whether parents feel like they're a partner in the child's education, that has increased slightly since 2012. The school district being well managed, about the same as 2012. Trustworthy administrators, what are folks' perceptions of trustworthy administrators? A little more so than 2012. Whether we have well-trained employees, again, pretty good. Communicating effectively, preparing students, providing life skills, and integrating economic and ethnic diversity to support harmony in the district. So again, from the 2012 being the dark blue line, you can see we've increased certainly perceptions in those areas from a few years ago. We talk about categories of performance. What are the perceptions of our curriculum? Certainly increasing. We've got a ways to go with curriculum. As I mentioned earlier, Carmen is with us as a assistant soup for curriculum in a position that hasn't been around in almost a decade. So there's a lot of work that hasn't been done in the last decade that we're now trying to catch up on in terms of revising curriculums. You know, we talk about updating all of our assessments, formative assessments, professional development. There's a lot of things that go into this position that have really not been happening to its fullest potential over the past several years. Services, perceptions of teachers, again, doing well. Perceptions of principals, perceptions of our facilities, perceptions of safety and security in the district. Perceptions of our website and how well our website is in terms of being informative. Experience with the most recent contact, how was that? And communications overall. So you can see in each of those areas, the perception is stronger than it was several years ago. This next set of slides is really looking at high impact areas and our perceived performance. And so what you want to see is markings up in the upper right-hand quadrant of this chart, because that gives you what folks feel are very important, have a big impact to your operations of your school district. And so you want to be able to have high performance and a high impact. So you want to be in that upper right-hand corner. So when we look at priorities and where things currently lie, you can see communications strong, teachers strong, principals moving up strong. Curriculum is still needing some work down at the bottom. Services needing to be looked at for improvements. Our website is gaining. Recent contact is okay, but we have some work to do. When you compare this to where it was in 2012, you can see where we've moved. Again, you're wanting to be in the upper right-hand corner. So teachers has moved up into that quadrant. Curriculum is moving up, although we just started in that category. Perception of principals has moved up. Safety and security has moved up. Services has gone up slightly, has become a little more impactful. Our website and our website redesign has shown some improvement in perception. Communications overall has increased. So you can see everything is starting to move into the directionality of that third quadrant, or that upper right-hand quadrant up at the top is where you want to be for the highest impact. When we look at curriculum in particular, and you look at level of challenge, computer skill development, health and PE, math, music, problem solving, reading, science, writing. So taking each look at subject by subject and the perceptions on those, you can see in most cases better than before. Computer skill development is about the same, maybe a little less. Obviously, that underscores the need to keep up with current technologies. As you know, technologies, within 6 months, whatever device you have is now old news. So keeping up with that is quite difficult. When we talk about finances and looking at a bond issue going forward, our machines, our computers we currently have in the building are now 6 and 7 years old, purchased from a bond issue from several years ago. You know, it's so important to keep that replenished so that those upgrades can keep going and our programming can keep up with the speed of technology. Again, we've increased perceptions in each of those categories. We have a ways to go with the revisions of these curriculums. So this is just baseline data for us at this point. One of the things that we added on three questions at the end, so there's no basis of comparison, which is why you see three lone bars. Critical thinking, we think that's important. Integration of technology, and information presented in a way a student learns best, which we heard about a little earlier. Because really those are trends that we need to start thinking about moving into rather than just content. But what are you doing with that content? How are you structuring that content so a child is learning? And how do you know they're learning? As far as perceptions on teachers, their qualifications, perceptions on their qualifications, their ability to motivate, their responsiveness to student needs, responsiveness to parent concerns, organization and preparation, demonstrating care for students, ease of contacting them, and then we added a question about responsiveness to diversity, because again, we feel that's something that we want to harness and accentuate in the district. Again, perception-wise, compared to 3 years ago, better. As far as services in the district, food service, transportation, before and after school programs, support for students with unique needs, tutoring and academic support, tuition-based preschool, athletics, and then English language learner support, which we have an increasing population of limited English students in the district, which we are continuing to grow a program to accommodate. You can see tuition-based preschool and athletics have dipped a little from prior years. So we're investigating why that perception is takes place. Athletics, it can simply boil down to whether or not you have a winning record in football or not. And in the fall, when the survey is given, if you're not 500 on your football scores, people think your athletic programs are bad. So it's all a matter of perception in terms of how they view athletics and what drives that. So, but again, those are areas for us to take a look at as to why there's some decrease in perception, particularly with the preschool, particularly with athletics, and what that route may be. Perceptions on principals. Again, responsiveness to concerns, openness to improvement of ideas, innovation and solving problems. And then we added questions that weren't asked before that dealt with availability to parents, their knowledge of educational leadership, and responsiveness to diversity. Because all of our buildings have become very diverse, particularly over the past several years. Under communications, how do people most likely, or how do people want to receive information, I should say? Most say by email. That's now the preferred way of getting information. You see text message from 3 years ago has increased also dramatically. People are texting a lot more now than they did in 2012. So folks, you can see the big change there. But email by far is what preferred way of folks to get information. When the question was asked, who did you have most recent contact with in the district? By and large, it was the teacher. And then we broke it down into, with that particular contact, how was that conversation? How did that conversation go? Were you able to reach that person? You know, what was the ease to which you could reach that person? Was the person accurate in their response to you? Was it complete? The speed to which that response was handled? Your ease of working with the school district or in the school system? And the pleasantness of the person that you spoke with. So again, these are sort of communication, PR, customer service types of questions. And so you can see a teacher is the white bar, a parapro is the dark gray bar, principal is pink, a district administrator is the orange bar in the middle, office staff is the light blue, guidance counselor is the darker blue, and then the brown is a bus garage or a bus driver contact. So you can see level of satisfaction of each of those types of queries on responses. And again, this is very important for us as we look at, again, having conversations about customer service with everybody in the organization. When folks were asked about why did you choose Avondale, or what keeps you in Avondale, the most frequent response is academic performance, followed by quality of staff. Those are the two most frequent responses, followed by safety and security, location, school reputation, class size, student diversity, and so on. But you can see academic performance and quality of staff hugely outweighed all the other categories with why folks either come to Avondale or stay in Avondale. When we talked about if we had to reduce the budget, where should we reduce the budget? folks said, well, you should expand number of services with area districts. Look to where you can see to share services, which we currently are doing. We share services transportation with Troy, for example. Expand outreach for school of choice, drawing in more school of choice students. That's been a recent board conversation, particularly looking for next year. Reduce voc ed was not the same response as we got in 2012, because you can see the pendulum is starting to shift in terms of the need for that vocational ed. We talk about engineering, we talk about all of those hands-on types of high school programs. That pendulum is swinging back. We heard about the shortage of electricians and plumbers and welders and tradesmen. Not everybody is college bound. And that was the platform for the past two governors that we've had, is gearing everybody towards college. Everybody becoming college ready. Well, we're soon identifying that not everybody is wired to go to college. And when we do that, our trades are all suffering. So now, as we're getting to the latter part of Governor Snyder's time in office, his tune has changed a little bit in terms of when he initially came on board. His platform was totally different. It was college bound, college for every kid. Now he's not saying that, because we've hurt ourselves in the service industry so much by having that mantra. Reduction of athletics programs. Again, not as popular as they were several years ago. Reduce extracurriculars, reduce services at the high school, academic center, increase class size. None of these are popular, but just trying to gauge what types of things would be, if we had to cut budgets, where would those fall? Folks thought we should increase marketing, which we are doing heavily. That will help to offset conversations about budget cuts. Doing more in terms of fundraising, going out for a millage, although since Proposal A in 94, we can't go out for millages, only bond issues and sinking funds, which are not operational monies. Those are only bricks and mortar monies. So there's a difference in terms of what we can go out and we can levy. But it's nice to know that if folks were given the opportunity, that there's support for that in the community. Increase pay-to-play fees, reduce costs considered with administrative costs, ancillary or transportation costs. So, and all of those things we continually look at. When we talk about future growth, what are some things that we should be keeping our eye on the horizon for? What are things that we should be thinking about in terms of new programs, new directions for the district? Overwhelmingly, the top choice that people have said was developing an early college program at the high school level. And that is something we're currently doing. We are looking at starting an early college program this coming fall. Through Baker College. So that's something that's being rolled out as we speak. Expanding partnerships with Oakland University. We're going to hear in a little bit from Marsha Hudson, who's going to give us kind of an update in terms of that OU-Avondale partnership, but looking to expand some opportunities through them. Expand advanced coursework, more dual enrollment opportunities, which we had mentioned earlier. Develop and expand a foreign language program. Again, very popular with elementary parents wanting a foreign language program. Develop an entrepreneur or business academy. Develop an engineering academy. Expand virtual or online options for kids so they can have more opportunities to take things online. Develop media arts. Implement IB, that's International Baccalaureate. Strengthening students' international experiences, developing biomed. So you can see kind of the continuum of things that folks felt more important than others that we should be gearing ourselves towards. And this is breaking it down in terms of where most of the responses came from by level, with blue being elementary level, middle school being the orange, green being high school, and all being the darker green. So you can see at what levels parents with students, where those responses came from. Folks also felt important that we need to offer trades opportunities. Opportunities for kids to be able to get certificates, welding certificates, plumbing certificates, all of those types of things. College prep courses, and start programs young. Don't just leave innovative programs for high school, which traditionally schools have done. Start them as young as elementary. Which grade level should have the greatest emphasis? Obviously, high school received the most votes on that one, because that's where you have the most elective opportunities in your schedule to take those types of courses. There was a question about, would you be willing to pay additional monies for your child to be involved in these types of innovative programs? And by and large, across the board, folks felt yes, they would, that they would be willing to pay monies to be, to have their child in some type of a engineering academy or a biomed academy or IB or any of those types of things. There's a question on there about recreational millage. That would folks be, if a recreational millage was on the ballot, that would pay for things like after-school activities, clubs, take care of club fees, transportation fees, after-school, everything but MHSAA athletics, because you can't put MHSAA athletics under a recreational millage, but everything but that. Folks felt, yeah, they would support that. And then there were some questions on here that dealt with Title I. And Title I are monies that we receive from the federal government for high-risk areas. We really have two schools in which we receive Title I services, and that is Auburn and Graham. And we do receive some funds at the Avondale Academy. But those are specifically for high needs populations of kids that are federal supplements to assist with those needs that those children bring. And so there were questions on there that dealt specifically with parents who have children in those schools. So that's why you see so many that say no, because they would come from a school that didn't have those funds. And then there's a series of questions about of the services that are provided with those extra funds, have they helped their child? Is the perception that those programs that were put in place with those federal monies to help those at-risk children, have they worked? Are they helping? And so this was some of the feedback from those parents. Again, in comparison to 2012. And then, are those changes regularly? Are they irregular? To what basis are you seeing those benefits? Whether they've received information about being Title I. So all of this information really helps to guide us into identifying the perceptions and identifying perception versus reality. As people fill these out, you know, they're coming to those questions with a certain experience with the school district through their child. And so it's incumbent upon us to really look at those responses and really weigh out the strategies for how we make those improvements within each of those areas. We consider this information baseline as we're setting up, you know, a new structure, a new strategic plan. It'll be interesting to see how these results change when we give this survey 3 or 4 years out from now, because it'll really measure the impact in terms of the work that we're doing today toward that end. Also in your packet, there is what is considered a heat map. And a heat map is, if you thumb in there, you'll see some pages that have red and blue squares. Different shades of red, different shades of blue. And what they've done is they've taken all those questions from the survey. They've put them across the top. And then as you go down and look at each of those boxes, if it's a blue, the bluer the box, the more in agreement folks are, the more positive they are. The redder the box, the more in disagreement they are, or the more improvement they felt was needed. So that's why you see different shades. So the bluer the better, the redder, meaning more improvement. And they've got that structured in such a way by the demographic of the particular person who responded. So you can track it by folks in a certain age group and how they responded, or folks that have certain students in certain grade levels. So demographically, you can look at how people responded to each of those questions. But it's just interesting to look at in terms of following the trends of what folks felt very strongly in blue and kind of where it kind of went into areas of red as to what they signified as areas of improvement or need. It's kind of a different way of looking at data at a snapshot. So any questions about the survey data that you have? And again, I'm not going to go through the specific staff survey that is in your packet or the feedback from each of the sessions from the fall. Again, that's in your packet. But it really mirrors the information that's reflected in this community survey. It's very, very, very similar. Yes?
Couple of questions. Why did we do it in 2015 when we had it in 2005?
Because that was under an old regime. We had a different structure set up. We had different priorities at that point in time. And so we felt it important, particularly to kick off this process, to grasp what those current perspectives are. And again, use this as baseline data to look at as we grow.
Okay. I presume some actions were taken out of the 2012 survey. And I presume there was a target. Was there a target? In X number of years, we want to be Y in these ratings.
In 2012?
When we did the survey and we got the results, and then we say, okay, we need some actions to be implemented, and this is the target. Was there any target that we...
In 2012, from what I've seen, there were some targets. In the old strategic plan that was developed again before I was here, there were some targets that are there that I think are reflected in the survey. Did we meet those targets? Some, not all. That's why I felt it's important for us to sort of start over with a new set of perspectives as we feed this process. Okay.
Now we have compared ourselves to the average Michigan.
Correct.
Do we know where's the best rating? You know, because I would like our school district to be the best. So do we know where we want to be? Or do we know what's the best in Michigan? So that we can compare, not just to the average, I want to compare what's the gap to the best.
I don't have that information because this is, again, an independent company that did this. So that would be something I could ask them if they have a particular district they did that was at the top. Frankly, when you're on a 100-point scale, you want to be at 100. 99 is not good enough.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, that's where I'm at. So it's, you know, I don't, for me to compare to whoever's at the top, if they're not 100, they're not worth us comparing to.
Mm-hmm.
Lessons learned. Lessons learned, yep. And that's something I could approach COBOL if they would release that information.
I presume the data is there, but if you see the respondents, it's primarily the major response from the high school area.
Correct. Because so, that's where we have most kids.
Right. Can we get a picture or have we understood between elementary, how does the elementary responses, how is the middle school responses, and how the high school responses in those individual categories that we are trying to?
We're looking at that. Okay. Yeah, we're looking at divvying that out and deciphering elementary, middle, and high school, so that strategies are specific to each of those buildings around the data that's shown there. A lot of that we're getting from those heat maps that are in there, mm-hmm. the red and the blue. Because that breaks it down to where the kids are coming from. So we know where the responses are coming, middle, elementary, and high school, primarily from that set of data. But as we move forward and we look at, again, the goal setting exercise, this information is going to be critical to go back and reflect on as you have, you know, a major portion of the community that this is their voice. So as we look to design strategies and action plans, that's something that we want to keep coming back to and reflect on, because that's very important information. Carmen's going to finish up tonight with her curriculum area presentation that will focus on curriculum instruction assessment, test scores, and so on. We have a little activity we're going to do at the very end of the session today, but we promised to get you out at 8 o'clock, and we want to stay to that. So I'm going to turn it over now to Carmen, who's going to get you going underneath tab 2 in your binders.
Good evening.
Good evening.
All right, we're almost there, so hold on, okay? So my name is Carmen Kennedy Rogers. Carmen Kennedy, I recently got married, so I'm still figuring all that out. So I am in charge of curriculum and instruction, and you're probably like, hey, what does that mean? So I'm going to try really, really hard to explain this to you in the next 25 to 30 minutes. I did share with you, and hopefully you did receive it, an extra handout. This is my PowerPoint. There are some extra data pieces on there. Everyone have one? There are some extra data pieces inside of this packet that if for some reason you didn't understand or it went over your head or you glazed over, whatever, it's all here. So connect, inspire, and achieve. And in the middle, the focus is always Avondale students. So, I'm like, well, please click, and I'm the one who clicks, so here we go. Connect, inspire, and achieve. We hope to connect with our students through curriculum to make sure that it is relevant, that it is meaningful to them, that it is something that they can carry on with when they graduate from Avondale schools. Inspire through instruction, and I put in parentheses teaching and learning. For me, the word instruction is very adult heavy. Instructing means that I, the adult, will give you, the child, the information. So it's more of a focus on teaching and learning. It's a little bit of play on words, and we want to be as student-centered as possible. And you achieve through assessments. And sometimes we do use these beautiful things called standard-based assessments, the state of Michigan assessments, but we also have things like formative assessment. If you remember the video that the high school team played, there was a math teacher and the kids were holding up the whiteboards. That is formative assessment, meaning that the teacher right then and there can make a correction or make a compliment to learning. And sometimes we may take a test and a week later we get it back. We lost our moments for teachable moments in terms of learning. So there are multiple ways of assessments, and assessments can also come through qualitative data. What kids say, we have plenty of examples around here in terms of cultures of thinking. So basically, my responsibility, and I am a district-wide focus. I am focused on curriculum, instruction, and assessments. And let me be very clear, I am not the content expert. There are teachers who are the content experts. I am the person who will provide the resources and the materials, the support, the guidance, the glue that holds it together. I make the joke, I'm kind of like your sugar mama. I'm the one that has a little bit of money to make it happen. But I do not proclaim to be a content expert in every single content area because that's really not realistic. So I believe it is my responsibility to empower, to uplift, and to build capacity among our teachers, our teacher leaders, and our principals and assistant principals. So when we think about curriculum, these are some of the basic components. Curriculum, basically, the teaching and learning plan and plans developed by teachers or for teachers, and I will share with you two examples of that this evening. Scope, basically, are clearly stated learning objectives and content expectations. And we will talk a little bit more, like Michelle, you pointed out earlier, which is a great point. What are our kids supposed to be learning? Those are the learning targets, the learning objectives. Sequence, the order. I pay attention to vertical, meaning what is happening pre-K, yes, the little babies, all the way to the older babies, the 12th graders, and I pay attention to what's happening. If we have, for example, three ELA classes, English classes in seventh grade, are we somewhat consistent across the grade level? Are we consistent from Graham, Deerfield, Auburn, Woodland? That's what I pay attention to. I pay attention to the horizontal and the vertical. I also pay attention to the resources and the materials that are provided. And probably the other three pieces that I pay attention to is consistent, coordinated, and flexible. And the interesting thing about this work is that I believe that there should be consistency in structure. At the same time, I believe in flexibility. Because our teachers are building administrators, they are the experts. So you cannot always micromanage everything, but you should have expectations. Here, I decided when I first came into Avondale, and I've been here since July 1st. So when I first came into Avondale, I did an audit of my own, and I looked at our school improvement plans. A school improvement plan is like this really exciting document. It's a blueprint. And what I should see, what we should see in our school improvement plan is our alignments. For example, what I read in the Deerfield school improvement plan, to the Woodland school improvement plan, to the Graham school improvement plan, to the Auburn school improvement plan, I should see some consistency. So I kind of did my own audit. Were there consistencies? Yes. Were there consistencies? No. So my part of my responsibility is to provide that platform and to provide that systemic thinking and those consistencies, and it is definitely a process. But one piece that I did pull out, and this is also from listening to Dr. Schwartz and learning more about our direction as a school district. So one of the curriculum focus areas for this year, it's kind of like going to Panera where you pick two because there's so much work to do. And sometimes quality is best when there is a smaller quantity. And so the picture at the bottom, that's the rabbit and the tortoise and the hare, you know, that story. So sometimes in order for us to go fast, we have to go slow. So because I know that our resources are limited, I know that people's time is stretched, and I know that our plates are full, I picked two curriculum areas to focus on this year. The first one is in writing, and it is a pre-K through 12, because our babies, our little ones, they are developing that writing muscle very early. Specifically, we picked argumentative writing. Why? Because it's a 21st century skill. It is the muscle that helps build critical thinking. Critical thinking is a 21st century skill. We also know that our students need to be good communicators, not LOL or BFF or something like that. So we have to develop that muscle. We also know that when our students enter into the workplace, they have to be able to make a claim and back their claim up with evidence, and not because I said so. They have to write rationale and logic. So this is the muscle that we're building right now. And so I'm giving you a really quick snapshot of our time in writing at this time. So the argumentative is the spectrum. It's opinion, persuasive, argumentative. Do we really expect our first graders to be able to argue? Well, maybe they can. But to write an argument claim or a statement, no. It is a building. So we go from pre-K to the seniors. We talk about the maturity of writers, their emotions, and when they write, well, I like popcorn because it makes me feel warm and fuzzy, versus research evidence-based. And we are also looking at vertical and horizontal alignment and differentiation. Because within writing, in the classrooms, not only thinking is messy, writing is messy as well. And differentiation, we have kids who are in special education services, we have kids who are gifted and talented, we have kids who come to us and they're reading, their vocabulary is very low. So we have to think about differentiation and how do we make that happen in the classroom. And so an example of what we are attempting to do, and thank you to Marsha Hudson in sharing a document today. And I will speak specifically right now what we have been doing elementary. One of the things I have to do when I think about resources and materials, because it's my responsibility to manage those resources and materials. So I sent a survey out to teachers early on, asking them questions about what resources are you using for writing? Because we have a whole lot of stuff, but we have to bring it on in. So you do a survey of voices. I learned we have everything we absolutely need, but sometimes it's too much stuff, and therefore we get lost. So the work that specifically the elementary Avondale Writing Committee, what we have been working on is taking all this stuff and drilling it down. And so that it will not get lost in something on the shelf, and so that everybody can understand. So for example, this is a piece of work that we are working on. This is literally a draft, and I have first grade. So we have something called Common Core Standards, and this is the fancy language. This is what first graders are supposed to be able to understand. Write opinion pieces in which they introduce the topic or name the book they are writing about, state an opinion, supply a reason for the opinion, and provide some sense of closure. That is what a first grader should be able to do. What? What does that say? That's that fancy language of Common Core. So what we are doing, and I also have this wonderful glory of being able to visit different classrooms, and what I noticed throughout the school district without, I'm not sure how purposeful it was as a school, as a systemic school district, but in all of our schools, we're using something called ICANN statements. So why not turn that Common Core fancy state standard into ICANN statements? So this is an example of an ICANN statement for a little first grader in terms of opinion for first grade. I can write and draw about the things I like and do not like. So when this goes home to you as a parent, you see the I can statement of what your child is able to do. Not only is that I can statement, Mr. Holly spoke about it earlier, but that kid is, we also are working on student self-assessing, reflecting. So that I can statement is very powerful, the power of language, I can. I can write and draw about the things I like and do not like. I can write at least one reason for my opinion. I can use all I know about words and chunks of words to help me spell. So those are I can statements. So basically, we have taken this long, fancy language, run-on sentence from the Common Core State Standard, and we have drilled it down into I can statements. Those I can statements are our standards, they are our learning targets, they will become part of our rubric. We are building into a district-wide common assessment for argumentative or opinion-persuasive argumentative writing. Once we get to that piece, we then can start looking at what do Avondale writers look like when we speak about argumentative writing. It is an absolute long process because not only am I working, for example, with the elementary teachers, but they also have other things on their plate. I don't know, they teach. So, you know, it'll be really fun if they could come out every week to the committee, but that's not realistic, and that's really harming the students. So part of my journey is to try to pull all this information together for them so that we can continue to share out. And so my process is continuing to share out and share out. I have also met with the middle school in learning, are we horizontal? And now I'm working with middle school eventually to make sure we are vertical. And the high school is pretty much on track. And I have used, fortunately, the expertise and the experience of a couple of the high school teachers to help in terms of building the middle school. So this work, it takes a lot of collaboration to work on something such as argumentative writing. And when we have a small district, like I was at a presentation today, and I was listening to the curriculum director of a district, the seventh largest district in the state, Chippewa Valley. They have content area. They have content leaders for every area, every grade level. So there's like 30 people on staff. What? Not happening here. So, you know, this is a systemic. And what I'm saying to you, this is a systemic process that we have to go through. Because just because we put it on paper, does not mean that the teachers will follow it. And I'll explain a little bit to you in a minute why it's important in terms of professional learning. Another focus that we are looking at this year is the transition from eighth grade math to ninth grade algebra one. In eighth grade, students have two options. They take eighth grade math or they can take algebra one. And the algebra one credit at eighth grade, it can transfer into your high school credit. Or when you go into the ninth grade, you take algebra one. What I had learned from looking at the data are success rates in terms of algebra one at the ninth grade level were very low. So what do we need to do? Another initiative that that took place before I came on board, Math Expressions is a new math program in our elementary level. So now it's my responsibility to make sure that Math Expressions, which is our elementary program, is now aligned to our middle school program, which then will be aligned to our high school program. So I decided to start here because I had the greatest amount of data in this piece. And what we discovered by teachers just sitting down and talking is that we needed to back up and dive deeper. Sometimes in curriculum, you have all this stuff. We can go very wide, but we needed to go deeper. So what we are working on right now between the Avondale Academy, Avondale High School, and the middle school, we are actually creating I can statements for each unit. So when we start doing what I would call a crosswalk of curriculum or diving deeper into curriculum, teachers are now creating I can statements. So the goal ultimately in all this is to be able to put these I can statements on the internet for you to see as parents and staff and members of this district. And not only, and these I can statements would not be tied up in fancy language, but you can see what your child is learning. You can understand, and you can also support them at home. The other piece that it helps in terms of us as a district in the world of public education, people move around. So one teacher has maybe been teaching 30 years first grade, maybe that teacher will now get shifted to teaching fifth grade. That person should be able to have access to the curriculum, to the I can statements. So I am working with several folks and we are hoping that we are able to take all this curriculum and put it online and make it transparent. And that is a process, believe me. So that is the goal. That's how we are we will make curriculum transparent. Next year, focus areas, next generation science standards. Science is a concern nationwide. What we will begin to do this year is start collecting the voices of teachers across the district in terms of what are we doing in science. From then, we will begin to build and make sure that we are in alignment with the next generation science standards. You heard from Dr. Schwartz, and our feedback is foreign languages. Over the winter break, I actually met with Irma Torres from Oakland Schools. She is our consultant for foreign languages in Oakland County. And so now I am looking countywide, what is everyone else doing in terms of foreign languages, pre-K through 12? So I'm beginning that piece of work, kind of just building the foundation. Health education, we need a lot of work in that area. We need updated materials. We need to make sure that our teachers are updated in terms of their information. And secondary math, now that we have invested time and money into math expressions elementary, we now need to make that investment into our middle school and to our high school as well. The other piece that I am responsible for is instruction. And I explained to you teaching and learning. So they, you know, we have things like training where you go somewhere and you get trained how to log in or something that exciting. And then we have another piece of professional learning, professional teaching and learning. It's called professional development, one size fits all. And the goal is to always provide teachers with professional learning because it is continuous, it is personalized, it is focused, it is embedded. And next week when you come back, you actually will hear from Marsha Hudson, who will speak about Teacher Lab, which is an example of professional learning. So professional development, I would use it as, is one size fits all. You sit somewhere like 4 hours and someone talks at you. Professional learning means that you can take what you have absorbed and immediately apply it to your classroom. The focus is always professional learning. If you open in under the tab number 2, you will see what we have done so far in terms of learning experiences in Avondale. So on the first side, professional, and I do recognize it's a collection of training, development, and professional learning experiences, but what have you been doing beyond the walls of Avondale? A variety of different focus areas, and you can read that information. But I also share with you what are we doing within the walls of Avondale, that's on the backside. I do want to call your attention to a couple of things. In terms of our principles, if you look the fourth block down, learning walks for principals, so many times as principals, and previously I was a high school principal, we are so caught up in the management of a building. And we don't always have that time to focus on being the leader of a building. So what I had the opportunity to do first semester with principals, I engaged with principals in what we call learning walks. We just visited classrooms and we talked about instruction. Because that's really why we're here. We have to do the fire drills and reports and the attendance and all those things, but we're really here for instruction. So I believe that I'm also responsible for helping our principals become and continue to evolve into instructional leaders as well. So I'm hoping to provide a lot of opportunities for everybody in terms of professional learning. Because of other issues in the world, we're always not able to provide professional learning development during the school day. So there have been a couple of opportunities that have been provided after school. For example, we have heard several times about cultures of thinking. Well, when you implement something new, it has a great cost to it. And so a way that I thought, again, I have this wonderful opportunity to visit all the schools, and I knew hands down that our four elementary schools were strong in cultures of thinking. In our high school, they were just starting a journey in September. So an after-school volunteer enrichment opportunity that that was provided to our high school staff, they did visit Graham and Deerfield. And they did what we call a ghost walk. A ghost walk simply is kids are out of the building, teachers are out of the building, and we just walked the hallways and went into the classrooms, and we learned so many things about cultures of thinking. And that is a cheap way of providing professional learning for folks. Is it Larry the Cable Guy? Get her done? That's kind of my mentality, just get her done. You play the hand you're dealt and you figure it out. We always don't have the money or the time, but we have to provide the learning opportunities for teachers. So that is a way that we are hoping to continue the systemic spread of cultures of thinking. Balanced assessment. Assessment is another piece that I do, and what I will quickly go through this. In your, in, also in your packet, all the MSTEP data from last year. You have MSTEP data from the elementary schools. If you go to the back page, then you have the MSTEP data from the middle school and the high school. You then have MSTEP data countywide, so you can see where we sit in terms of MSTEP data from last year. MSTEP will happen again in the spring. This past year, 2014-15, that was the baseline data. So there's some information for you. I will not go through that, but you do have that information at your fingertips. Something that we are working on this year, the college entrance, college and career readiness exam is SAT. And to make sure that by the time our students get to the 11th grade this year, oh, they already had it. Yes, they already took. So our 8th graders took the PSAT last week. Our 9th graders would take the PSAT in the spring. Our 10th graders would take the PSAT in the spring, and then our 11th graders. This is another piece of data that I will look at. I do not look at data in every single classroom. I look at data more on a district level. And now I will share something with you, which is also part of my responsibility. I share with you in the PowerPoint, it's not in your slides, excuse me, it's not in your binder. This is the PSA, so our 11th graders get ready for the SAT in the spring. They took the PSAT in October. Here are the scores for Avondale High School. Here are the scores for Avondale Academy. So that information is on, it's on your slides. I'm not just skipping over it, but you have that information. But another reason I look at data is that I believe that there should be a systemic and ethical need to respond. And I am picking this piece of data because I probably had it and I had the most access to it. So specifically, I looked at the data from the Avondale High School Fall 2015 PSAT data. And I broke it down demographically. And so as the curriculum person, I have to think about what is our curriculum, what are we doing to prepare teachers, what are the relationships, the culture, the climate, what are the interventions we need, what other relevant data points. So I am going to spend time talking through this with you. So there is the Avondale High School Fall 2015 PSAT performance results. And let me say this first. And I am about to talk about the achievement gap. The achievement gap is not only an issue in Avondale, it is an issue in Oakland County, it is an issue in Michigan, it is a national issue. And in order for us to address these issues, we have to acknowledge them and pay attention to them. So you will see that the student test takers, there's a breakdown in terms of ethnicity. So 229 students took the test. These are juniors at Avondale High School. The mean score overall was 965. That was the mean score, meaning that was the score from two parts on the PSAT, which is basically English, reading and writing, and math. So the mean score was 965. Then I took that data and I broke it down by race and ethnicity. And if this last table down here, when we look at the achievement gap, our black students were 68 points below the mean score. That's a gap. And we have to address that gap. And the way that we address that gap, what do we need to do differently in terms of curriculum? What do we need to do differently in teaching and learning? And you already learned from our high school team that they are making sure that teachers are approaching learning differently, project-based learning, kids working collaboratively, not a sit and get. We have to talk about relationships, culture, and climates. Do our kids need mentors? What more do they need? We have to talk about enrichments, interventions, and supports. What can we do differently with our academic center? What can we do differently? Can we provide additional classes that provide more support academically? And we have to make sure we're looking at the relevant data. So again, I picked this piece of data because I had the greatest access to it. And this is data that we have to talk about. And it is data that is probably, and I know that it is a reflection, again, not only what is happening district-wide, but is happening in Oakland County, in Michigan, and nationally. Where are the gaps, and what do we need to do about that? So that's another focus area that I have as well. I also share with you in your PowerPoint, Avondale High School. Let me go back to this for a second. Another reason why we have to look at the performance data, because unfortunately in the state of Michigan, we are judged off of these 3 to 4 days of testing. And when your students who are in the subgroups, when they do not perform well, therefore your school does not perform well. So if we just want to talk about it from a viewpoint of we have to have good data so our school is rated in a certain way, another reason to address it is because if Avondale wants to continue to stay on the map in terms of student achievement, we have to look at our subgroups. But I go beyond that. It's an ethical response. That's the reason why we look at subgroups. We have to look at what is happening with our students in special education, what's happening with our students who are English language learners, what's happening with our students who are in poverty, because those kids matter. So sometimes people look at this data because it looks good for the district, and sometimes people look at the data because it's an ethical response. I believe in ethical response. So this is the information, moving on. This is the information, the graduation rates and information for the high school, for Avondale Academy. I also share with you other pieces of data. We use iReady data, which is a growth assessment. We give that 3 times a year. That data is there for you. I look at 2 things for that. I look at performance and growth. I will give you an example. When we look at math, Woodland is outperforming the district in math. When I look at growth, Graham is outperforming the district in growth. Interesting conversations to have. I also share with you what is iReady data looking at. All the information is there for you. And finally, another piece that I am actually working on with, I started this conversation with Mr. Brooks, Jamie Brooks, who's the assistant principal at the high school. Transitions. Let's look at when our kids transition from 5th grade to 6th grade or 8th grade to 9th grade, what do we need to do differently? So, okay, I'm a sports fan, Nike, faster and stronger than last year. So we are focusing also on the transitions, and we are starting the early conversations about a transition program for 8th to 9th graders. And our questions are, who needs more and different? What is needed? How do we know? You identify the students. We start identifying the students with data. We provide additional enrichments and supports. We collect and analyze the data. We make the adjustments, and we do it all over again. We know that when kids transition, either they do really, really well, or they get lost. That transition is so important. So the vision is, let me find a piece of paper I can rip up. For our kids who probably did not do so well in the 8th grade, what we want to be able to say to them when they enter 9th grade, rip up your transcript from the 8th grade, it no longer matters. It is now time for you to write a new story. With that support, we are hoping to provide some type of summer enrichment activities for those students. If it's project-based learning, if it's just getting used to being in the high school, we are hoping to provide those students with mentors, 11th graders and 12th graders. We are hoping to get them into the high school and used to being a high school student before they actually walk through those doors. And that's very, very important. And we're hoping that we are able to continue to invite teachers to the table, of course, for that. Because if those kids are connected with an adult in the school and they're connected to some other kids, their chances are better. So what we already started to do, and I shared this information with Mrs. High, the high school principal, we are already looking at MSTEP scores, we looked at current 8th grader, 7th grade MSTEP score. So we have an idea of who those kids are. We will look at their MSTEP scores, whatever scores we will have at our hands by June or so. We will look at their grades, and then we provide those supports. We have a great partnership with a woman, her name is Diane Baldwin. She is a community member, and hopefully we can work with her to provide some additional supports and through grant money for this type of program. But this is a very, this is very early on the stages, but part of kids being successful to 12th grade are those transition years and that data, and we know that. And finally, one of my favorite people in the world is Dr. Seuss. All the places that you will go, you have brains in your head, you have feet in your shoes, you can steer yourself any direction you choose. And that is my whole focus through curriculum, instruction, and assessment, is to make sure that kids have absolutely everything they need, no matter who they are, where they come from, in order to be successful. And it's my job to empower and to support the teachers and the administrators who are responsible for their learning. Any questions? Thank you.
A big thing I know, even on social media watching, is math.
Yes.
Common Core math. Uh-huh. Which is great. I like, but is there, are we doing anything to teach the parents this new math so when these kids come home with the homework, mm-hmm. we can help them?
So, that is something we have to improve upon. So math expression, are we speaking about math expressions? You're speaking across it.
My mind started in fourth grade with the new multiplication.
Okay.
And could not even help my son.
Yes.
I was very grateful he was in the special ed program, so he had help, but the parents who have the general ed kids, they don't have, you know,
yes.
that
yes.
That teacher yep. back, you know, behind them, helping them, that resource teacher, have nothing to go on.
Right.
So then these kids have no idea. Well, then by the time they get to sixth grade, it's like, now you're really, the parents are completely lost with the, you know, because they haven't even learned this new multiplication,
mm-hmm.
you know, like we know that there's this much and these kids are doing the mm-hmm. problem, this, you know, whole page long.
We do have to do a better job in educating parents. We do. I mean, you know, I think the and again, that's also my responsibility, but, you know, teacher plates, their plates are loaded.
Right.
I mean, you know, you have Ms. Abbott over there on Twitter or Instagramming or whatever you're doing.
Not right now.
But I think it's also my responsibility to help leverage those supports. So, yes, the education and information for parents is very important.
Yeah, I mean, big time.
Yep.
You know, yep. couple, you know, times a month come to learn at least how to do the math to help your kid,
yes.
you know?
Yes.
Why, do you hear you're doing it wrong for your kid?
Completely.
I hear it all the time.
Khan Academy has mm-hmm. the videos.
Yes, they do.
And yes.
the parents, I don't know whether the parents realize that Khan Academy has the videos to explain.
Step one, step two,
yeah,
step three, step
one,
four.
You know, mm-hmm. when you set up your matrix, what it means.
Yes.
Oh, that.
So and it's even,
you know,
but
mean,
even just sharing those resources.
Yeah,
yes.
That's, mm-hmm. Perhaps the parents would be helped by doing something.
Mm-hmm. Math expressions for parents 101. I am always available and around, so if you have any other questions, let me know. Yes.
Regarding PISA performance, where you have broken down the data mm-hmm. to ethnicity, and you said we got to bridge the gap. Right?
Mm-hmm.
So, good. But focus is there, that's great, but what are we doing for not to lose focus on gifted or talented kids?
Can I?
All means all.
Okay, so another program that we are working on, Dr. Scores spoke earlier about our early college program with Baker. That is a program that could be geared towards more gifted and talented kids. We also are in the early stages of exploring our gifted and talented program as well for implementation 2017-18. So the focus is all over the place, so to speak. Yes, yes.
But they have a group of kids from middle school taking geometry. So there's 6th, 7th, and 8th graders, and they can now skip the 9th grade science for those kids who are, and they are wonderful with those baby squirrels at the high school, because they are squirrels. And Mrs. Ellinger is wonderful.
And I'll speak, like, for example, at our elementary levels, kids, let's say your son or daughter's in the third grade, I'm making this up, and they are able to possibly take on fifth grade, that is definitely a possibility. that kids made for that hour go to a fifth grade classroom.
But that facility is not available in all schools.
Yeah, it's not consistent across the
country. Okay. So that's obviously...
It's there in Auburn, it's there in Deerfield, but not in Woodland.
Okay. Noted. But Deerfield has great score. I mean, Woodland has great math scores. I just want you to know that.
Again, the consistency piece is something that, you know, we've got to look at in many areas. And that's another one. So.
We're going to close up with a couple of big ideas and key themes for today. One of the things that is has happened over the last several hours is you've had a lot of data poured into your ear. And the notion that we want to be very clear about is we need to turn that into information that can help us plan. So as you leave with a notebook full of information, we hope your curiosity is piqued. You're going to go home, you're going to look through those pages, and when you come back again, there will be more conversation about what it all means so that we can use that as very firm foundation to help decide, so what do we need to do about it? Because we've talked about some of the what, we're talking about now what, and then so what is it going to look like when we have reached that plan being fulfilled. Another piece is that you're probably very clearly understanding there's an art and there's a science to teaching all children well, because the questions that we ask have to be about everyone. Is this segment of students, this segment of students, students new to the district, students that have been in the district for a while. What about girls? What about boys? What about English language learners? What about kids who are ready to be accelerated? What about kids who need some support in scaffolding? Because our responsibility is for whoever walks through the door. That's the challenge of public ed. I'm going to draw you a picture as kind of the grand finale for what I have to say to you this evening, and I ask your indulgence, because a great artist I am not. But it is a way to summarize the key and important messages as you're walking out the door tonight to be thinking about, and then Dr. Schwarz will close. When you know what this is, no. Oh, you get the last cookie on the plate.
Oh, no.
How about that?
This is like Pictionary?
It could be.
Can we just time it out?
Hamburger.
Hamburger. All right, Mr. Holly. We're starting a hamburger, or a chicken sandwich if you would rather look at it that way. And I would ask you to consider this as a focal piece for what school done well means. It means we are attending to
where's the beef?
All of our students. All of our students. It also means we are attending to not only the learning of the students, but we're attending to the learning of the staff. Because what is the single most important factor in a student's achievement outside of or things that are within our control each day? The single most important factor is the quality of the teacher in the classroom. So we need to attend to the learning of the students, the learning of the staff, and there's room for one more thing there. And it's learning of the organization. What is it about Avondale schools that will make them, to Carmen's line, bigger, smarter, faster, able to do their job more effectively through the strategic planning process, more effective next year than they were this year? For the work that's being done with staff, how can they be even more effective? What is their learning going to be about? And how can we improve student learning? All three are very important pieces if education is going to be done well. So as you look at the data and you look at the information that you can gather from that data, when you come back next time, we'll be talking more about the learning for students, learning for staff, and learning for the organization.
And to wrap things up this evening, as we are now past our time of 8 o'clock, we just want to thank you for coming out this evening and spending time with us. Again, I hope this information is valuable. It's going to take you some time to digest it, stew on it a little bit. We have some more information to present to you next time around finances, around special education, around the partnership. And then we'll be able to take all the information from these 2 days, kind of congeal it together, and begin to talk about how this starts to make sense with how it spins out into goals and action plans from there. So while this is a lot of information that you're getting, as you think about it and as it all starts to come together and those dots sort of connect, that's where we have the foundation built to move us into the forward conversations of where we go from here. So we thank you so much for coming out tonight. We thank you for your patience. Please bring your notebooks back with you next time. So take them home with you, look at them. As you have questions, jot them down through the week or whatever so that you have those when you come back next time. If there's more information you need on something, any part and parcel of this, just let us know. We'll get more information. Lastly, you have a little half yellow slip of paper. Suzanne, you want to kind of describe what that exercise?
It's back in the back, on the back side of the console there, just as you're going out the door. This is what, if we were in a classroom, would be called an exit slip. The expectation is if you're going to exit, you will turn this in. And what we would like you to do is jot down any initial feedback that would be helpful for us in the planning. Is there other additional information that you would find helpful? You've got inside your notebook a kind of the bird's eye view of what we'll be talking about next time. Again, student services, looking at teacher learning and what the professional development looks like. You'll be hearing about HR, you'll be hearing about the business side of things, you'll be hearing about athletics, you'll be hearing about technology. If you have some specific questions or other observations, we invite you to do that because just as in a classroom, we can tailor your learning as adults more effectively if we have some feedback. So on your way out, if you have information for the exit slip that would be helpful, write it down. If you don't have anything, just put a line or say a thumb up or a thumb down or what were you thinking or I need more information about or please get us more information on this topic. So leave us an exit slip. Thank you so much.
Thank you. And remember, next week on Thursday, we are at the middle school. The Middle School Media Center from 4 to 8 next Thursday night. So be careful driving tonight. I hear it's gotten slippery outside with the new snowfall. So please be safe and have a wonderful evening.